Those of you that are present in the room, if you're going to be speaking today, please sign in. And when you're asking questions or answering, I should say, we ask you answer, please identify yourself so our home listening audience knows who you are. You know, I want to begin, as we do every day in this committee, with the Pledge of Allegiance, and I will ask Representative Duba to lead us. We'll start with our pages. There's a microphone in front of you. Please tell us who you are, where do you go to school, and if you've got any future plans.
Right here.
My name is Sky Katolik. I am from Bonhom County. I go to school in Tyndall, and I plan to go to cosmetology in Sioux Falls.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Alexa Comas. I am from Watertown. I go to Waverly South Shore, and I plan to go to Grand Canyon University for pre-law.
All right. Well, great. Thank you. Well, welcome. Thank you for coming over. This is the best committee in the legislature, so just keep that in mind.
Look, they're all nodding.
Yeah. See, they're all nodding. With that, I'm going to ask the secretary to take roll.
Senators and Representatives Otten. Kasson.
Here.
Mills.
Here.
Wick.
Here.
Duba.
Here.
Foster.
Here.
Johnson.
Here.
Kroll.
Here.
Maher.
Absent, excused.
Carr.
Absent, excused.
Koth.
Here.
Kolbeck.
Absent, excused.
Bolin.
Here.
Wink.
Here.
Van Huysen.
Here.
Breitling.
Here.
Derby.
Here.
And Hunhoff.
Here.
Madam Secretary, we do have a quorum.
Thank you. Do we have any minutes? No minutes. Okay. All right. Then we're right moving along. All right. You know what a taskmaster I am. You have the agenda. We've given you time, and we want to try and stay with that, but also appreciate we've got new members on here. And I was just thinking in my head, we have now representatives from universities, you know, of course, SDSU. We have USD that's here. We have Northern that's here. Is there anybody else I'm missing? Oh, School of Mines. Thank you. So we've really stepped up to the plate. So now you've got your lobbyists that are on the committee for each of the budgets that are going through. So you can appreciate that. With that, then I'm going to say good morning and welcome for those of you that are going to begin the presentation.
Thank you so much, Madam Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Pam Roberts. I'm president of the South Dakota Board of Regents, and we really appreciate you having us testify today. We'll be here for the next couple mornings, giving you some information about our system and also letting you know about our legislative wishes. So I wanted to just start out with an overview of what the Board of Regents does and is. We have the constitutional authority to govern the system of public higher education in the state of South Dakota. And we, of course, provide leadership and set policies for the programs of our six universities and our special schools. Our mission is to provide an excellent, efficient, accessible, equitable, and affordable public university and special school system, which would improve, of course, the educational attainment and research productivity while enriching the intellectual, economic, civic, social, and cultural life of the state, its residents, and its communities. So with that, I'd like to just start off by introducing our Board of Regents. I'm from Pierre. I've been on the Regents for 6 years. I was recently reappointed, so I will be coming up for Senate confirmation here this year. On teams is our Vice President, Jim Thayers from Aberdeen. Also in the room with us today is former judge and actually former past president of the Board of Regents, John Bash. And John, I'm going to have you just stand up and wave. He's from Belfouche, and he drove out here today to be with us. He stood. Okay. Joan Wink from Howes may or may not be related to somebody sitting at this table. Joan has been an excellent member. She brings a really interesting and good perspective to the board because she has been a college professor. So lots of us don't have that experience, and she has been very helpful to a lot of us as we've learned the regental system and the faculty system. Jeff Partridge is from Rapid City. He is a former legislator. He actually used to be on the Appropriations Committee, and he chairs our Budget and Finance Committee. So he has a wealth of knowledge, and now he's bringing that to the system and also learning a lot about the system. Joan chairs our Academic Affairs Committee. In the room with us today is Tim Ray from Baltic. Tim has been a regent now for a couple years and will be coming up into the executive team here soon. Tim, did you stand up?
I did.
Okay, thank you. We just need to make sure that everybody knows who he is. I know that nobody here might not know him. Okay, and then Brock Brown is our student regent, and he's from Lake Norton. He graduated from SDSU in May, and he's now a law student at USD, and he is a really great student regent. He brings that student perspective to us, but he also brings a really good perspective to the board, and just, you know, he's a regular member. He has a vote just like the rest of us. And we have two vacancies. One has been vacant for a while, but our recent vacant, of course, was from someone that had to retire or resign from the Regents and become a member of the legislature. And we certainly will miss Regent Van Heusen, but now we respectfully will answer any questions from Representative Van Heusen. Our executive director, Brian Maher, his son was the kicker for the Cowboys football team, and he is on a plane coming home right now. So he's not going to be able to be with us today, but his our chief of staff, Nate Lucas, is taking second chair, soon to become first chair when I get up and walk away. So with that, Madam Chair, I think I'm just going to turn it over to Nathan, and he's going to have some of the executive team come forward and be introduced. And thank you again for your attention, and we look forward to working with you all session. If you have any questions, comments, suggestions, all of the Regents' numbers are on the website, and we'd be happy to talk to any of you at any time. So thank you.
Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Chairwoman Roberts, I think most of our time is going to be spent today talking to Mr. Maher about those four extra points.
Okay, I'm glad he's not listening right now. Poor guy. As a parent, I was like,
yeah, that was tough.
So
thank
sad.
You.
He's had a great season though, so hope and brought it back and made an extra point. So that was good. Okay, thank you.
Well, good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Nathan Lucas, I'm the Chief of Staff and General Counsel for the Board of Regents. I will do my best to not only be brief, but to also channel my inner Dr. Maher, so if I tell any jokes that miss the mark or seem extra corny, that's why. No, I'll just start real briefly. I know we have a lot of seasoned vets on this committee, as well as some new faces. So I want to give a little bit of overview, but won't get too far into the details. You know, as I'm sure you're aware, system is comprised of six universities, two special schools, and then we also have campuses, Black Hills, Rapid City, as well as USD Sioux Falls. You know, so what does that mean? Well, we have roughly 33,600 plus students within the system, 4,300 or 4,600 benefit eligible employees. So it's a fairly massive system. And within that system, you know, we have an $800+ million budget, 260-ish from general funds, with an economic impact of over $2 billion a year. So it's a fairly significant system with a lot of impact to the state on an annual basis. And maybe I should have started with where we'll also end the presentation, and that's just with a simple thank you. The last few years have been tremendous for higher education in the state, and all of you have really helped set the stage, not only for this year, but for the next decade or so to come. We've worked really hard as a board to really try to shore things up, focus on what's really important, and how we can best set the system up for success moving forward, and you all have been instrumental in doing that. You know, whether it's the, you know, the Freedom Scholarship or the flexibility that you provided with setting tuition in Rapid City or Sioux Falls, to the various building projects, increasing our M&R, all of those things have really helped bolster and position the system for success moving forward. A couple of other high points, you know, system enrollment this last fall was up close to 1% headcount, you know, so not a significant movement, but a movement in the right direction nonetheless. And more importantly, I would say, is our first-time students. So this last fall, we saw over 6% increase in our first-time students within the system, which was huge. And you'll hear, as we go through our presentation, one of the common themes are, you know, recruitment, retention, and affordability. And if we can stick to those focal points and accomplish those objectives moving forward, I mean, we should be able to turn that 6% increase into something huge in the coming years. The other thing I wanted to touch on, you know, sometimes higher ed gets a bad rap with respect to workforce development and what kind of students or degrees are you producing. And I wanted to note that last year we produced over 5,000 degrees within the system. Over 75% of those degrees were in healthcare, science, business, education, and agriculture. You know, so when you think about what are the high need occupations, you know, what's the backbone or lifeblood of South Dakota, and over 75% of our degrees last year kind of hit into that area. So again, just real briefly, I know a lot of you are well aware of the Office of the Executive Director, but so we have our system office, which is essentially the day-to-day of the board. You know what Regent Roberts didn't mention, we have a board of regents, but they are effectively a volunteer board. They meet 6 or 7 times a year. You know, they get their $75 a day per diem, but it's not a full-time job. You know, the Office of the Executive Director is really the, you know, the lifeblood or the day-to-day of the board to help, you know, whether it's carry out their policy directives, draft policies, collect information, steer the campuses. It's really where the rubber meets the road for the board. As you might imagine, and I'll introduce the staff that we have in front of us here, the executive director's office comprises, you know, some of the same things that you would expect to see on a campus. So we have, obviously, executive director, Dr. Maher, academic affairs, we have Janice Minder, who will be talking with you here briefly, our finance and administration, we have Heather Forney, myself as general counsel, human resources, we have Kayla Bastian. We also have a Regents Information System, and I don't believe Dave Hansen is not here today, but the Regents Information System is essentially probably easiest to correlate with BIT for the executive branch. It's really the IT arm for the system. And then we also have the Information and Government Relations area, and we have Cherie Mortensen, who is our Director of Communications, and then Liza Clark, who is our Director of Government Relations and Economic Development. You know, so when you think about what it is that the system office does. You know, oftentimes people look at it and say, well, if you have academic affairs in the system office, why do you need it on the campus or vice versa? And they really don't overlap a ton. You know, we're constantly assessing and try to figure out what makes sense to do as a system, what type of oversight, what type of regulation should be happening at the system office applicable to all campuses, you know, versus what are the strategic areas or things that make sense to happen on the campus. And one of the things that kind of really highlighted that interplay or interaction between the system office and the campus was Senate Bill 55. And realizing that was 2020. So we've had 3 Senate Bill 55 since then. We probably need to come up with a better name to reference that. But just real briefly, a few of the high points from Senate Bill 55 that we've accomplished, as well as some of the things that we're continuing to work on moving forward. I know you've all heard about the conversion to our single dining vendor for the entire system. So Sodexo does food service at all of our institutions. And that was something that, you know, wasn't easy to implement. Certainly were some growing pains as we've transitioned into the one vendor model. But it saves students roughly 5% of their meal plan costs. I mean, that's money that actually went back into the pockets of our students. You've obviously heard about the single nursing out in Rapid City, as well as some of the work that we've done on the university centers, now BH Rapid City, as well as USD Sioux Falls, to try to make them more viable moving forward. At the December meeting, Heather Forney presented in detail on some of the work that we're doing regarding our general fund allocation, as well as tuition and fee structure, and how do we best position the system or structure things moving forward. One of the huge areas that we have ongoing right now is an HR assessment, and that's really the, you know, the crux of my comment on trying to figure out how best to how best for the system office to interact with the campuses, what needs to stay at the system office versus what should be at the campus level. And we identified human resources as an area that just made sense to take a little bit deeper look in. And some of the things that we're doing there is creating a system where HR is a direct report to the system HR officer. You know, so not having six independent actors, but having everything funnel up through the system office. Another thing that we're in the middle of is a classification and compensation system that would be applicable for all of the NFEs across the system. You know, similar to what you see in state government across all of the different departments, but having a common system so we're comparing apples to apples and have a better sense for what's occurring on each campus. And then just generally speaking, looking at what are some of the system processes that we can do more effectively or efficiently through the central office versus repeating them six times over on each of the campuses. One of the other things here before I turn it over to Janice Minder is that we had a strategic plan that came out of the Senate Bill 55 process, which kind of really helps pave the way for the next five or so years moving forward for the system office. And, you know, I'd mentioned recruitment, retention, and affordability being critical at this juncture for the system. And I'll turn it over to Janice here, and she'll expound a little bit more on that.
Madam Chairperson, Janice Minder for the Board of Regents in the area of academic affairs. I'm excited today to talk to you today a little bit about what we've been doing in the system, and certainly with broader audiences and stakeholders, such as working with the Board of Tech Ed, the universities, the technical colleges, mapping your future, many stakeholders from state government, such as Department of Education and Department of Labor and Regulations. As we just talked, we created a strategic plan that came out of Senate Bill 55. One of the major initiatives was access and affordability. Part of that is to increase FAFSA completions by 5% in the state of South Dakota. So working on a process to help students, seniors, complete their FAFSA. Many reasons to do this. We know that National College Network Attainment has identified that if high school students, so seniors, complete their FAFSA, 92% of the time they will go on to a post-secondary education. So we created a coalition of stakeholders to work through the value of post-secondary education, and specifically looking at FAFSA completion. In that process, our stakeholders included Board of Regents, Board of Technical Education, Department of Education, Labor and Regulations, technical colleges, universities, and Mapping Your Future. The goal here is really to increase awareness of FAFSA completion. The first thing that I have to do is say thank you for Freedom Scholarship, because that does put extra focus on FAFSA completion. You have to have your FAFSA completed in order to apply for the Freedom Scholarship. Over the last year, the Board of Regents implemented what we call FAFSA Completion Portal. That is a technology that is in the hands of high school counselors that give them access to when a high school student has either completed or not completed their FAFSA. So it opens the door for or channel for communications. So we've been working really heavy with the high schools right now. We have 76 high schools committed to the FAFSA completion portal. Of those 76, 48 are actively using the FAFSA portal, and those 48 on average have increased FAFSA completion by 3%. That's a great success story for the state of South Dakota and for those students completing. Just to give you an example of FAFSA completion statistics within the state of South Dakota.
Yes, can we, okay. Pause, we have a question. Representative sure. Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For our listening audience, would you, what's the acronym FAFSA, and what is the exact process, or what's it used for?
Sure. free application for federal student aid, and it is a federal application that's free to seniors to complete that will give them eligibility for Pell grants and or federally subsidized loans. Okay. Again, Janice Minder with the Board of Regents. If you look at the slide that we're looking at right now, slide 9, you'll look at the statistics for FAFSA completion since 21 and 22, the first academic year. If you look at that, we are at about a 22.7%. We implemented in 22, we implemented a FAFSA portal pilot to 10 high schools that first year. So you'll see in 22-23, we went up 23.10%. So we're looking at the FAFSA completion year, right? So a high school student will complete for 2021-22, then they'll complete for 22-23. Right now, they're completing for 23-24. So it's always ahead of us. So right now, if you look at 23-24, 24.4% of high school seniors within the state of South Dakota have completed their FAFSA. We are at about an 8% growth at the same time last year for FAFSA completions for seniors in high school. We're very excited about that. We enjoy the partnership with the high schools. The high school counselors do a great job working with their students, and I think this attests to that work that they're doing every single day.
We have a question, Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I appreciate that information. That's very encouraging. But the question is, are the scholarships that these students apply for, how soon after they apply for them, and do they receive that information that they've been accepted underneath these programs? I know at one time it was April, and I believe it's been moved to January. I think that'd be some good information to bring to the table here. Thank you.
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record. You're absolutely correct, Senator Colbeck. We used to do our first initial approvals in April. We have moved that back to January, so students have first knowledge of receiving scholarship for first-time freshmen in January. So that's the Board of Regents system, so the 6 public universities. So our goal really is to get that information out as soon as we can so that students can make decisions early on in the phase to attend one of the 6 public universities in the state of South Dakota.
Follow-up, thank you. And just a comment, I really do appreciate the Board of Regents and Dr. Maher and all the people that were involved with that to get that moved up to January so we now can compete with those out-of-state universities that award those scholarships to those students in January. And I know Dr. Maher was really excited about it in the Board of Regents because he told me, quote, that probably within 3 years that might affect the enrollment is by as much as 500 students in the state of South Dakota, and I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Another question, Representative Koth.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question is, do we know how that 24% compares to other Midwest states, take Nebraska, Montana, Wyoming, North Dakota?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record. We actually right now are ranked 6th among all the states in completing our FAFSA with the percentage increase. I would have to get back to you to identify where those Midwest states fall, but of all the U.S. states, we're 6th in our completion. So I can, Representative Koth, I'll follow up with that to show you where the other Midwest states fall.
Follow up, please. The only reason why I ask is just, you know, if there's a metric out there, what is our goal? And if it's a national goal or more regionalized, I think that would be good to know something. What are we shooting for? Thank you.
Madam Chair, Janice Minder, just a follow-up. We're in the process of completing a reporting tool that will be statewide. It'll be public, and it will show our state of South Dakota as compared to the U.S. Ranking so that we can at least compare us our completion rates to the U.S. rates, and I think that's going to be helpful as well. So we do have metrics in place, and what we're also looking at least the Board of Regents, is where are we at last year, and how can we continue to increase that in South Dakota and try to reach as high as we can within the U.S. There are some states that require FAFSA. We do not in the state of South Dakota. However, we encourage it, and there are things such as the Freedom Scholarship that will require it. So those are all helpful to encourage students to complete the FAFSA. Another part of our strategic plan identifies transfer students as a population of students that we'd like to increase, and some of that is the work that we have with the Board of Technical Education. I have been fortunate to be able to work with the Board of Tech Ed in the process of looking at partnerships. And when I talk about Board of Tech Ed, I'm also talking about the technical colleges. So the technical colleges and the university. In April of last year, we held a meeting with all of the vice presidents from the four technical colleges, the six universities, and we worked together on a plan to increase transfer between the systems. It doesn't, it could be from the tech colleges to the universities or from the universities to the tech colleges. One of the outcomes from that is an updated board policy for transfer. So we're really excited about our new policies for transfer, really to look at seamless transfer between the Board of Technical Education and the Board of Regents. In addition to that, what we are working on right now, it will likely get approved in the June-July Board of Regents and Board Tech Ed meeting, is a nurse articulation agreement. And so what we did is we brought the four technical colleges and the two universities together to identify that RN to BSN stackable credentials, so that if a student completes at one of the tech colleges, they can come right into the Board of Regents. Right now, we have about 8 agreements, and we're consolidating that together to one agreement statewide between the four tech colleges and the Board of Regents. So we're very excited about that. We have made tremendous progress. We're in almost the final stages. We'll bring that articulation agreement for formal approval at the June Board of Regents meeting. The last thing we're working on with the Board of Tech Ed is a seamless student portal. That student portal would allow students from either the university system or the technical colleges to go on and look to see how do their credits transfer back and forth. Again, really exciting work that's happening between the technical colleges and the universities.
I'm going to stop you. Do you have your fact book? You know, I'm tied to that.
Yes, I do.
I want you to go to page 19, where you talk about transfers, and I want you to please explain the two tables that you have present there at the bottom of the page.
Okay, so the, Janice Minder for the record. So the first one we have is just transfer policies to show you the changes that have occurred by campus and by system over the previous year. So you'll notice that we are down in that first chart showing transfers between. But if you look at, and that's based on 21 to 22, so we're in the process of saying we know that we have a challenge with our transfers. We want to increase that awareness. And so our policies have changed to help us accommodate that. Now, I will say U.S.-wide transfer population is down across the U.S., not just South Dakota. But hopefully with our policies that we've implemented, that will help us increase that population. Lastly, if you look at the bottom of page 19, you'll notice that we have regental policies that allow internal transfer. That means from in the university, so Black Hills to Northern or Northern to DSU. That's the first line, and you can see that across our system, we have 176 students that transferred internally. That means it's a seamless transfer. They do not have to do anything. All of our information is in our student information system. They seamlessly can transfer from one university to the next. If you look at the second line, which is the important line, is the South Dakota Technical Colleges. These are your four technical colleges. Right now, we're at about 120 students system-wide that have transferred. And this is where we're trying to partner with the Board of Tech Ed to increase that. So once you have your associate's degree from the technical colleges, is there a pathway for a multiple certificate into the Board of Regents? And so we just started those conversations. We're moving from nursing to another field to be determined yet. In April, the Board of Regents and the tech colleges will meet again. And we're slowly looking at those stackable credentials to say, how can we continue to work together to increase transfer between the systems?
So I do have a question on the 120 that transferred. Do you know what the major, you mentioned nursing, and that's my assumption. Am I correct on that?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record. You know, I do not know that for sure. I'll have to pull that data for you, and I'll do that. Yep.
Representative Otten.
When you're talking about the percentages in the state going down then compared to the national, are they really comparative?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record, yes. It, across the U.S., and when we were doing the fact book this year, we specifically looked. Across the U.S., transfers are down. I don't know if that's a complication of COVID. I'm not exactly sure why that is happening, but it is across the board down.
are those numbers on percentages about the same as South Dakota?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder, for the record, that would be correct, yes.
Keep going, because I'm really interested in the other institutions.
Yes, sounds good.
Outside institutions, I should say.
On the chart, you want me to keep going on, or do you want me to move on with my presentation? Okay. Oh, so the outside, other South Dakota institutions would be our private institutions or tribal institutions within the state of South Dakota. And then last one is outside. So outside the state of South Dakota, you'll see that that is around 871 students. And lastly, we have some that are in process. That just means that their information wasn't completed yet. It's still in work of being transferred into our system. Overall, though, our goal is to increase those numbers. We identified a 5% growth within our strategic plan. So our goal is to continue to work on those transfers so that it's seamless in-state and out-of-state.
Okay. So I'm asking out-of-state, do you have any data as to indicating why these students are leaving out-of-state? We don't have the programming here or what?
This would be, Madam Chair, Janice Minder, for the record, outside institutions are coming into the border regions. So that's what this is. Yep. All right. Carry on to the next slide, slide 11. The other area that we are working on is to increase post-secondary value of education and career readiness. So this is where we're talking about how do we help middle schoolers and high schoolers and first and second year college students be successful in the state of South Dakota. We have right now a really fun initiative going on called Our Dakota Dreams. It is a campaign that was grant funded, and with that, what we're looking at is providing free college application period. In the past, we used to do a 1 week period. We have opened that up now to 2 months where we could actually go out and work with the high schools across the state. Sometimes they'll have evening events. We also partner heavily with Mapping Your Future, who does FAFSA completion meetings with parents at the high schools. We have also implemented a new program called Free Online Tutoring. This is really a COVID learning loss tool for students across the state. It's K through 12. It's free to students to utilize. We have Northern and Black Hills State as our tutors, so in the education program, and they work with those students across the board for any kind of homework help that they might need. That is a program that will go for 2 years, so by the end of next year, that program will be completed. The next exciting opportunity we have is the career camps, and these are free to 7th and 8th graders. So we're trying to right away engage students at an earlier age to show them the possibility, the art of what could be available for them for whatever programming they want. We partner with the technical colleges on this, so students get to stay at one of the universities for an entire week. And they travel between a technical college and that university, and they get to experience different programming that's available and tying it to careers. So after they look at that, they'll go into the workforce and they get to basically tour in, businesses that tie to those programs. Exciting for those 7th and 8th graders. Last year was our first year. We'll do it again this summer and again next summer. Lastly, with that grant funding, we are hosting a leadership academic or academy for teachers that have been teaching for 5 years, and that is really exciting. It's giving them an opportunity to experience. Our goal really is to grow our own administrators within the K-12 system, and right now we have a cohort of 60 teachers that are attending this. A goal to them would be to continue on into additional fields for that principalship, superintendent, leadership positions within the school district.
There is a question. Senator Foster.
Thank you, Chair. I had a question regarding the 7th and 8th grade summer exploration, summer camp. What schools are you currently working with, and how are those students recruited?
Madam Chair. Janice Minder, for the record, we actually open it up to any school. So we've actually had, I think almost every school district has sent a student or multiple students. It is free for those families to attend. We actually have worked heavily with the Department of Education to communicate to the school districts. with that process, and then we open up a free application and anyone can apply. We do specifically look for high need areas, those school districts that are higher need with absenteeism rates and things like that, to ensure that we have a good population of students that are attending. We typically try to do eighth graders first, because of course they will not be eligible when they're ninth graders, and then we'll open it up to the seventh graders.
Follow up. Do you have a cap on the number of students that can attend each summer?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record. We actually, this year we'll have a cap of 600 students. Last year we started with a cap of 300 and increased it to 400. If we find that the, and that's with very limited advertising, if we find that we need more than 600, we'll work with the Department of Education to open it up if we can for more.
I do have a question. How much is that grant? How long does it last?
That grant, we have several, so I don't want to give you the wrong numbers. Can I follow up after this? Yep, we'll do that. Yes. Yep. All right, the last exciting thing that I find exciting, but maybe nobody else will, as Nate's probably smiling at me, is we are working heavily with math support. So we would like to have our juniors and seniors who are coming into college be completely prepared for those math courses. So in essence, trying to cut down the remedial math and working with them right away as our juniors and seniors. So I'm happy to say we have a working with NSU and their e-learning, we have a teacher on staff that does high school readiness course, open to 75 students, free to the student to attend, with the goal to get them into math 114 while they're still in high school, so that we can work them through that college math with the professor or teacher that can help them be successful. So our goal is juniors and seniors into the math readiness, get them prepared, and then help them through high school dual credit to get into that math course that will meet their requirements for their college program. Exciting work.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. How do you identify those students that are going to need this these math skills?
So right now we have Northern State University principal working with the school districts to first advertise it, letting them know that it exists. We also are looking at criteria. We created a one-pager that said, if you are taking Regents Scholar math, you're probably not best suited for this. And so we have a principal that's working directly with those school districts to make sure that the right student is in the course that needs to be in the course.
Follow up. So you did this for this current calendar school year. How many students took advantage of this program?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder. The last number I looked at was in the high 60s, and we have a 75 cap.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm just going to follow up because you mentioned remedial, and we've had several discussions about the remedial classes. Do you have any data that you can provide us? Have you seen a decrease then in remedial, or this is just a new program, and what's the time frame to evaluate?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder. Absolutely. This is the first year we're implementing this. We have the funding for 3 years. So every year at the end of the year, we'll be tracking success. So that means, did they pass the course? Did they go on to college math? Did they successfully complete that? And at the end of the 3 years, in that fourth year, we'll actually be checking on those students to see how well they participated in college as far as success in math. So we'll be able to provide you data and statistics on all of that information.
Yep. Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Minder, we have the Board of Education coming up, and these are all great programs. I'm just curious why these are being done by the Board of Regents when it sounds like maybe it should be more of a Board of Education issue.
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record. Actually, we're partnering really heavy with the Department of Education on almost every one of these items. I think that the goal was really to try to engage the university system and getting the students, for example, seventh and eighth grader, to be housed at the campus, at the university, with the college professors. Same with the online tutoring. We have our students are actually being the tutors with the for this program. So it's really our resources helping to get this information out there, but not alone. Department of Education is partnering right beside us. We meet with them almost weekly to discuss needs and goals, objectives, where we're at. So it's not a standalone. We are truly partnering with them. In July, I believe it was, we had a joint meeting with the Board of Tech Ed, Board of Regents, and the Board of Education to continue to give them updates on where we're at. So it's truly a partnership.
We have a question from Senator Foster.
Is Indian education a part of these conversations and partnerships?
Madam Chair, Janice Minder for the record. Right now, they have not participated, although we've opened it up for their students to attend as much as they can and want to.
Thank you.
I think that's the end of my presentation.
Madam Chair, we're going to transition and bring up Heather Forney. She's going to stick with recruitment and retention and tell you a little bit about the Dakota Advantage program.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Heather Forney, Vice President for Finance and Administration for the Board of Regents. As Mr. Lucas stated, I'm going to continue with our recruitment and retention theme and talk to you specifically about a program that we call Dakota Advantage. This was implemented in fiscal year 20 for the first time as a system where we offer resident rates to non-resident students from the surrounding states from South Dakota, including Colorado. Prior to fiscal year 20, you'll see that there are numbers in fiscal years 18 and 19. We kind of had one-off situations where if I'm at USD, I could get resident rates. If I was from Iowa or Nebraska, if I was wanting to attend BH, I could get a resident rate if I was from Wyoming or Montana. And so what we did in fiscal year 20 is we kind of consolidated all of those one-off programs and went with a system situation where all of those states and Colorado would receive resident rates at all six of our institutions. Fiscal year 20 was the first year that was fully implemented, and since that point, so from fiscal year 19 to fiscal year 23, we've more than doubled the number of students participating in Dakota Advantage.
I have a question. So when I go through each of the higher ed programs, and you have both enrollment resident and non-resident, the ranges run anywhere from 38 to 52% for non-residents. There is one that is rather low. So what are you doing for incentivizing, you know, that organization, that university that is significantly lower than the others, and how are you implementing that to measure the impact?
Sure. So, Madam Chair, what we're trying to do, I'm not sure that I'm going to necessarily answer your question, and it might be better suited maybe for the campuses particularly to address, and they are all prepared to talk about Dakota Advantage on their campuses as well. But really what we're trying to do with the non-resident rate, or the non-residents receiving resident rates, is to encourage people to come to South Dakota. We're a net importer of students from other states, and to try to essentially shore up what we have in our residence halls and participating meal plans. The more students we have on campus, the more feasible economically we can be for everyone. So that's kind of why we went to some of these things like the Dakota Advantage across the system, was to not provide an unfair advantage to one campus or another in recruiting students from particular states.
So do you have a metric out there that you're looking at to measure the effectiveness?
Madam Chair, so when we first implemented Dakota Advantage in fiscal year 20, what we did is we determined what a break-even would be. So if we are currently have, say, for example, 10 non-resident students from the state of Missouri, and we want to break even, so generate the same same amount of revenue, how many more students would we need to get at that lower resident rate to break even? And that was really kind of the analysis that we did to make sure we don't want to lose money in offering resident rates to non-resident students. So what was it going to take to break even? And when we reported back to our board in December before expanding this program to Wisconsin and Illinois, was that not only were we successful, we were incredibly successful and far outpaced ourselves on what we needed to break even. So that's really the analysis that we did, is we don't want to lose money on these situations. Are we successful in that? And we have been overwhelmingly successful.
Representative Kasson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Forney, and I suppose we'll probably talk to the individual campuses as well, but just as an overall, from your overall perspective, how would price play in sort of the, I guess, priorities when these students decide to choose one of these South Dakota colleges or universities versus, you know, one in their own state?
Madam Chair, Representative Kaysen, that's the number one thing, I think. Aside from, do you have my degree program? It's how much is it going to cost me are the two things that I think are overwhelmingly the topics of conversation in all recruiting, both resident and non-resident students.
Thank you.
Yeah, and thank you. And so of the 30,000 students that are in the system, approximately, whatever that number is, what percentage are from have addresses outside the state of South Dakota? Would it be, I assume it's between 20 and 30%, but just like to hear.
Madam Chair. Across the system, we have almost 62% are residents and 38% are non-residents, with that varying in degree by campus. And that, I know you guys hate me pointing you to the fact book, but it is, if you want more detailed information, it's on page 19 of our fact book.
Thank you. That's much higher than I thought. And if I just have one other follow-up, does the state of South Dakota, if a graduate of SDSU lived in Texas, would their child be able to come to college in South Dakota at the in-state rate?
Madam Chair, we do offer what's called a Child of Alumni program. So if you are a graduate of SDSU and you live in Texas and your child wants to come back to SDSU, they get a resident rate at SDSU. That okay. is correct.
So there's some little exceptions or whatever that go beyond just the states that we're currently operating under that program?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
The other point I would just make is that our board did expand the Dakota Advantage to the states of Wisconsin and Illinois, effective with our December board meeting. So next academic year beginning 23-24, if you are from Wisconsin or Illinois, you will also receive resident rates as an undergraduate. And then we expanded it as well to graduate programs. So what we were finding is I'm a student from North Dakota, and I'm at Northern getting my degree at a resident rate under Dakota Advantage. If I want to go on and get a master's degree from Northern, we were going to charge you a non-resident rate. And there were a lot of students that really felt like that was a bait-and-switch situation. Like, you got me to South Dakota on a resident rate under Dakota Advantage. Now I want to go to graduate school because I love it here, and I'm going to be charged the higher rate. So we also expanded Dakota Advantage to graduate programs, excluding those things like med, law, OT, PT, those kinds of programs that have caps, pharmacy. And we're really excited about that as well.
Is there national data that indicates that when you have non-residents coming in and you provide that kind of program, they remain in the state after graduation and enter the workforce?
Madam Chair, we've used anecdotally about 30% of students from from outside the state will stay in South Dakota once they've attended our institutions. We continue, as Mr. Lucas stated, affordability is really a key component for us. And so on the left is some information on the Freedom Scholarship for the board system. So our six institutions accepted about $4.1 million. Average awards were $3,700. For fall semester, a little over $2 million has been accepted. We don't have the spring data on there yet because we just didn't have that by the time we were presenting this. So we had over 1,000 students that received the Freedom Scholarship for our six regental institutions. Incredibly important. So thankful for everything that the legislature and the folks at Premier Bank were able to do to get this up and running. And so that's been very impactful to our students. And then on the right, there's some information on undergraduate resident tuition as we compare in the region. And you'll see that South Dakota is kind of the third from the right, and you would hope that we were a little bit closer to the left. So left to right is kind of the cheapest to the most expensive. But you'll also see that South Dakota saw no increase from 22 to 23. Again, thank you so much to the legislature, to people in this room specifically for making that possible with an $8.4 million base funding so that we could freeze tuition from fiscal year 22 to 23. We'll talk here in a minute about that being a priority for us again for fiscal year 24.
Just a question, was the 1,075 students, was that based on the dollar amount that was available so the maximum that could get a scholarship got it?
Madam Chair, the Freedom Scholarship was really each campus, each institution, including the private institutions, were given an amount. for Freedom Scholarship, and then they kind of set the criteria themselves on how and how much to award. There is additional information on that also in our fact book, the average award by campus, how many students, the percentage that were Pell eligible, because, you know, that really was kind of a focus because this is a needs-based scholarship.
I did look at that, but it's very comprehensive, and so I'm just asking, you know, for the success of this program, so all the dollars were allocated that could be, and students
yes.
got, and that's the, for the total allocation, that amount was able to serve 1,075 students. Basic question.
Madam Chair, yes, in the fall for our six institutions.
And is that what's projected out then for, what's projected out for next year then?
Madam Chair, I couldn't answer that.
Okay, all right, thank you. Senator Maher has a question.
Boy. Sorry.
Do you want to finish your last statement?
I was going to say on the right side for the looking at the tuition, the thing that I think is really important, but it's not on this slide, is I went back 10 years to see, you know, where have we been in the progression of increases compared to our neighbors. And in that 10-year period, while the state of South Dakota has increased mandatory tuition and fees roughly 15%, the average for the region is 29%. With some of these states increasing over 40% in tuition and fees over the last 10 years. And so, again, this is very much kudos to the legislature and to leadership in the state government for a freeze from fiscal year 22 to 23. We had a freeze back in the 14-15 era, and then our board also froze tuition on their own during the era of COVID. And that, I think, is why you're seeing such a low increase across our South Dakota system compared to our neighbors.
Okay. Madam Chair, the question I have, so when I'm looking at that 9,356 number, break that down for me. What does that include? How many credit hours is that? Does that include the university support fee? Does it include general activity fees, HEF fees? Is it all fees, or break that down a little bit for us?
Madam Chair, so it's roughly 30 credit hours, so 15 credits a semester. And then that is the resident rate, so it depends on the campus, but it's about a 250-ish range, and it includes the general activity fee. University support fee went away a number of years ago. It's been rolled into tuition, and HEF is actually a component of tuition, so that's all in there. And then we have two schools, the Dakota State University and South Dakota School of Mines and Technology, that have a laptop program, which is, I think, $400-some a semester at each one. That's mandatory for their students, so that's also included as we do the average. And so this is really kind of, it is the board's highest priority, and that would be really where retention and affordability meet with our biggest request for the legislative session of a tuition freeze. Typically, our board will set tuition at that March-April board meeting. Following legislative session, we increase tuition for the last number of years. The only thing we've increased for would be salary policy and any changes to health insurance. Again, you helped to fund a tuition freeze going into fiscal year 23. Our board froze tuition going into fiscal year 21 because of COVID. And so our campuses absorbed any salary policy that we were able to give to our faculty and staff. And so when we put together our presentation or our proposal for budget for 24, we were anticipating a 6% salary policy with no change to health insurance or a request of $8.6 million, very much like what you funded last year. What we know now is that the governor is recommending a 5% salary policy and a little over $2,000 increase per benefit eligible for health insurance. So that would actually end up being about $9.9, not quite $10 million to freeze tuition for 23-24. So different than what we had requested from the governor, simply because of the difference in the salary policy recommendation and health insurance.
Madam Chair.
Maher.
So if we were to freeze tuition, do you think we would move, it's probably too early to tell, but do you think we would move further left on that prior chart? What would be the outcome of that? What do you envision with that?
Yeah, Madam Chair, I'm really not sure, Senator Maher, simply because I don't know what everybody else is going to do. We do know, so when you saw the chart on the last page and you saw the decrease in North Dakota, there are some states like North Dakota that are doing things like banded tuition, where you get a set number of credits for a rate. There are some that have gone to a situation where there's no differential between resident and non-resident students, and those kinds of things. And so as we're working through our tuition and fee analysis, those are things that we're going to take into consideration for the future as well. But people are starting to make some of those changes, and I just don't know what that will look like for fiscal year 24.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thanks for being here today. It's always good to see you. Just a question on the tuition freeze. What actually would be included in that? Are fees, tuition, and anything else that might be associated with that to help them students out? Thank you.
Madam Chair, so it would be tuition. I'm assuming you would request fees as well if you funded it. But it for sure would include tuition. We know whether you would require tuition and fees, both or just tuition. There will need to be some adjustments to meal plans because of inflation. It's a contract that we have with our food service provider, so there will be some adjustments there. And then we're required to have some adjustments to housing because we've bonded for some of our housing stock. And in order to make our bond payments and meet all of our requirements, we have to have a little bit of an inflationary factor on there. So there will be whatever minimal adjustments we have to for food service and dining, or food service and housing, but that's pretty much it.
Thank you. So could you possibly give us a number that if we froze everything you just talked about to last year's rate, I mean, would you, because the $10 million evidently is not covering everything that a student has to pay for when it comes to tuition, food service, and fees, way you're looking at it here. But I mean, tuition and fees are very important to me.
Correct.
You know, I mean, we all have to eat and we all have to sleep somewhere. We understand all that. But if you could give me some kind of a number as to what that may come to above the $9,900,000 and some odd dollars that you have in the presentation today, I'd appreciate that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, I think I might have a little bit of a problem with the food service component of it because we don't have that information back yet from Sodexo. Since this is their first year of operations, we're literally in the middle of kind of truing up what happened the first semester. They're trying to figure out who liked what plans to decide what plans we're going to offer. But by the end of session, I can for sure have, I can have a more firm number, but I won't have it for at least a month, I would guess.
Okay. Thank you.
I do have a question. And page 20, top. So, and again, the data is only through 21, and you started this, the Freedom Scholarship just went into place. But if we look at enrollment, it's averaging any post-secondary somewhere in the mid to high 60s. Of high school students, but that's any. When we look in the Board of Regents, the higher ed system, that number keeps dropping. So there's other options that are out there. We just listened about the tuition to recruit non-residents to come in, really to support operations. If we're not getting from here, we're looking at them because you set a break even. So like I said, the data does not include the, you know, what the impact of this scholarship for, but what, you know, you're talking about all the things you're doing. The presenter, Ms. Minder, you know, gave that. But that's significant to me when you see that dropping, that our high school students are not going to higher ed. And so now we're recruiting from out of state to help maintain the operations. Is that a fair observation? And educate me how you're, what you're looking at to make that so that's not necessarily the case. We see that high school going to higher ed.
Madam Chair, we definitely, we've seen enrollment, quite honestly, has been dropping for a while now. And thus, we've been doing a lot of the things that Dr. Minder referenced earlier with the seamless transfer of students from the tech schools over to our campuses. The affordability, I think, is truly a component. When we saw a little bit of that bump up this academic year, I think it's, it has a lot to do with affordability, the fact that we were able to freeze tuition. And, you know, there are a lot of students, I think of my, both of my children that wanted to go to school out of state. They wanted to see something different. And so we've got to make what we have here really attractive. And when you're having conversations with parents and it's about what is my degree program, we're doing a great job, I think, in offering, you know, the kinds of degrees that we need here in South Dakota. And how much is it going to cost? I think by freezing tuition, by keeping those costs low, and by continuing on with things like the Freedom Scholarship, the opportunity scholarship, those kinds of things. Our campuses are really pushing hard to get additional scholarship dollars through their foundations. Those are the things that we're, I think that's how you're going to see the return here in South Dakota. And I think articles like, there was one that just came out not too long ago about how South Dakota is the number one state for return on investment with your degree of any state in the nation. And so seeing things like that, because we are keeping costs low, we do offer effective degrees, and people are going to make a good income here in South Dakota where it's fairly inexpensive to live. That's how we're going to continue, is just kind of slow and steady.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. That last statement that you made, where did that information come from, and how did they determine it? Regarding the best ROI.
Madam Chair, it was an article from Preston Cooper for freeop.org, the Foundation for Research on Equal Opportunity. And I'm not sure exactly what analysis they utilized, but it was, I can for sure send you the link to the article if you'd like.
Yes, thank you very much.
Senator Boland.
Yeah, and just a little bit of a comment too. You know, for, we just got the Freedom Scholarship passed and instituted just the last year or two. In the 4, 5, 6 years before that, I know the legislature had made a big emphasis to increase scholarships and funding for tech education, which I fully support. So I would think we might have had some of the students might have wanted to go to a four-year college, instead saw a very viable option to go to tech school. I think that might be a part of the issue here as well. Thank you.
Representative Van Huysen.
I'm just going to follow up on Representative Duba's question, because I read that article also, and if she sends it to you and you click through it, they kind of explain their methodology, and they really were looking at what the degree programs are. You know, oh, electrical engineering, here's what you should expect to make, you know, whatever, and versus what they charge. Yep.
Madam Chair, I know we're already at our time frame for the board office. The thing I would point out for those legislators that are new to appropriations, and when we talk about why we would need a freeze, it's simply because not all of our employees are funded through general funds. And so when there is a thing like salary policy and increases to health insurance for our benefit eligible employees, typically the legislature only funds those components for our employees that are generally funded. So when you look at the fact that 53% of our employees are funded through tuition and fees, we have to come up with that money somewhere. And so we have to increase our tuition and fees to accommodate it. And that's where all of this information is coming from, and why we talk about a freeze and how that's different from what the legislature typically provides us.
Senator Foster.
Yes, can you tell me a little bit more, thanks Chair, a little bit more about the tuition funded positions. How are those determined, and why the difference?
Madam Chair, Senator Foster, there's the specific positions will differ by campus. We've never been told these are the 52 people you have to fund through general funds. It's just simply we get a base allocation, and then we divvy it out to our employees. Typically, it will be, I guess I can't even necessarily tell you exactly who it would be on each campus. I know that when I was on a campus, I tried to keep people like our facilities folks, our administrative staff, as many people as I could fund on general funds in that allocation, because on most campuses, all we're using our general funds for is people and utilities. We're not using it for operations.
Follow up. So you said 52% are funded by tuition and fees. Can you give me the number amount on that?
It would be 53%. I can give you an exact number if you give me a couple. I can respond back. But roughly, we've got about not quite 5,000 employees, so slightly more than 2,100, 2,200.
So with the break, would you consider the positions that are funded by tuition and fees, and then as opposed to general funds, arbitrary and not necessarily based on anything specific?
Madam Chair, no, not necessarily, because most of the tuition and fee funded people are like your instructors. They're the people that are directly tied to instruction, directly tied to the tuition. So it's going to be your instructors and the people that are very closely aligned with teaching students.
Yeah, and thank you, Madam Chair. This is a my question is all is a, kind of about retention of your support personnel and things like that. I subscribe to the Elk Point paper, and I constantly see ads in there concerning looking for people, whether they're janitors, groundskeepers, HVAC people. How are they funded, and are you having trouble filling those positions, and does that are there open positions within your within the system? Can you just comment on that, please? Thank you.
Madam Chair, I can comment kind of more globally, but I'm not on a campus, so I can't tell you exactly who they have open, but I will tell you that we've had multiple conversations with my counterparts across the system about those individuals that are in facilities, maintenance, and, you know, general administration, like your administrative staff, are very hard to recruit and retain simply because they can go somewhere else and make more money. You can make $15 an hour plus benefits at McDonald's now. And so we've been having conversations about what kinds of alternatives do we have, what kinds of benefits can we offer beyond the typical state benefit to try and recruit and retain those people. Oftentimes, because you have so many vacancies in the facilities area, they'll give them bumps in pay because they've got, you know, we've only got 20 people instead of 27. And so taking the salary that we would have used for those seven vacancies, we try to bump up the salaries of the existing 20. And I think that's where when Nate Lucas talked about how we're doing this compensation study, I think those kinds of things will help us across the system to determine, you know, are we underfunding those positions as they are? Should we be doing something to kind of boost salaries in those areas?
Chair, are there any dependent benefits for staff or staff faculty?
Madam Chair, our employees receive the same benefits as the rest of state employees do. If you're asking if we get free or reduced tuition, we do not. I wish we did.
Thank you. Madam Chair, would it be appropriate for me to ask a question on the Dakota Advantage program before we get too far away from it? Okay. I would assume that with the level of competition for students being nationwide, is South Dakota an anomaly in offering that program, or is it getting to be more and more of standard operation for other states too?
Madam Chair, that's exactly what's happening. For example, when I talked about North Dakota and you saw kind of a decline there, there are many of their universities that have no differential between resident and non-resident at all.
Thank you.
How does South Dakota participate in the WUI, and how is this different?
Madam Chair, so Dr. Minder probably knows more about the WUI and the WICHE programs than I do, which are offering a competitive rate for members of those programs, but they're not necessarily, so I think, is Hawaii one of the, like Hawaii is part of the program. Well, there you don't necessarily get resident rates if you're from Hawaii. I think there's some kind of a 150% of whatever your state is, et cetera. So it's not directly a resident rate, even for those states in the WUI and the WICHE programs.
Follow up. Does South Dakota participate?
We do.
Okay. Thank
you. Okay. The really exciting stuff are legislative priorities. I've already talked to you about the tuition freeze as a base increase. This is our board's highest priority. You'll hear us talk often during session about whether things are on or not on our board's priority list. This is definitely on, and it's at the top of the list. We also had requested support for rising construction costs. These would be one-time asks. Our request was for $29 million, and it was scattered across a number of different projects that had already been legislatively authorized. But as time has gone on, we've seen significant increases in construction. So we submitted that request. The governor supported that in part, and you'll see that in a couple of upcoming slides. We had requested $32.6 million for building preservation. I feel like maybe Representative Mills would be fond of this particular request, as what we're trying to do is take the facilities that we have and really do what we can to preserve them. you know, we have some great facilities that we put a lot of money into for maintenance and repair, but they're so significant. Some of the needs on these buildings is so significant that with the M&R allocations that we receive, we just can't knock them out in a year or two, which causes them to be even more expensive. And so with this proposal, it's across all six of our institutions. It would be a $32.6 million general fund ask, and then we would match that with $32.6 million of our own HEF M&R dollars. And then $5.1 million cybersecurity update one time, which was included in the governor's recommended budget.
We have a question, Senator Mahler.
More of just for when that comes forward. On the building preservation, the 30, I'm assuming you're going to give us a breakdown and how that all works out. And then also something else. What's the longevity of these buildings? We're not going to put $32 million into them, and then in 5 years we put them into a landfill.
Madam Chair, we've been really careful about that for a long time. So I'm going to go through the following are just really quick. Again, here's that $5.1 million that was for cybersecurity upgrades. We'd actually asked for 8.1. The governor included 5.1 in her budget request or her supplemental for fiscal year 23. We're really excited about that. That is for our entire system. So not just at the board office, but for all six of our campuses, two special schools, and our office. Our base budget increases. You can see the tuition freeze was not recommended. We had asked for $7.1 million in maintenance and repair. The governor was recommending $4 million. I have a slide with some additional information on that in a bit. There's a $3.6 million request to transfer the research budget from the governor's Office of Economic Development to our office. That is truly just a dollar-for-dollar swap out of GOED's budget into ours. And what's happening is currently the money goes to them, they transfer it to us, we administer it. This just kind of takes out that middleman component, and it comes directly to us for administration. I see a look of confusion. Nate Lucas is here to answer questions. There is a governor-recommended National Guard tuition reimbursement for $1.9 million. That was not our budget request, but that of the Department of the Military, and we're supportive of that. System utility adjustments. Again, you pay for the utilities for all of our academic buildings, and so that's an adjustment. We've seen significant increases in utilities since last year. And then that lease adjustment for $2,500 is tied to a tuition freeze that happened back in 2015, where Governor Dugard paid off some of our bonds using general funds, and that gets reduced every year by the amount of the bond payment. Our one-time budget requests.
Senator Boland.
Got a question. Do you have, are you making efforts, or is there some kind of a system-wide effort to deal with rising utility costs, or is that something you're just going to have to absorb? Are you working to try to limit that as much as possible? Thank you.
Madam Chair, anytime, Senator Boland, anytime we make a, we have a new building, we have major renovations, it's always with an eye to efficiency. What can we do with the most up-to-date HVAC systems? Can we replace windows? I mean, that's where you see a lot of situations where we've got these old buildings that need to have LED lights put in, and they need to have windows replaced, and they need to have modern HVAC. I mean, some of the components of that $32.6 million are to that end. And every new building that we do has an eye to efficiency as well. We have a couple of campuses, West River, that are, they have someone that is really focused on sustainability. And so, for example, BH has input some solar panels, and they've got a wind turbine. We've got some dollars that we put forward every year to look at ways that we can be more efficient. We implemented things like every building has a meter so that we could see which ones are least efficient. And so those are the kinds of things that we're doing every year to try and chip off that. But when the commodity cost is so high and the wheeling costs are so high, those are the things we just can't control.
Okay. Thank you.
We have another question, Senator Johnson.
Thank you. On that same slide here, I'm sure I'm going to be hearing about the National Guard tuition reimbursement in the Military and Vet Affairs Committee, so you can give me a little bit of a heads up on this $1.9 million. And it was brought up earlier in this committee about out-of-state residents who essentially work for the state of South Dakota at the National Guard. Do they also qualify for this tuition reimbursement? They'll be asking for 100% from what I understand.
Yeah.
So how does that work?
Yeah, Madam Chair, that's So the Department of Military, these would be our South Dakota Guard members. So I don't know that I'm answering your question, but I believe it's just the South Dakota National Guard members are in this 1.9 million that you see here.
Well, Madam Chair, so South Dakota National Guard members are South Dakota residents, but they're also residents from Nebraska, Colorado, that live in Colorado that actually work for the South Dakota National Guard. So I was curious, and this was brought up earlier, about how tuition reimbursement would affect them. Must they attend a, well, just I'll let you explain it if you could.
Madam Chair, if you are a National Guard member, you receive the National Guard rate regardless of residency. So I guess I'm not.
What am I not making clear enough here? Go ahead.
Here's the question. I live in Crofton, Nebraska. I serve with the Yankton Guard Unit. But my residence is, I only come over here for guard training. Could I then go to a South Dakota school and get my tuition paid for 100%?
Oh, yes. Thank you. Thank you for the clarification, Madam Chair. Yes.
I don't know how. Sorry.
Yes, if you're a member of the South Dakota National Guard, yes. Under, if this is authorized. Correct. Sorry.
Madam Chair.
Representative Derby.
I just want to caution our committee, we're starting to dip into other budgets, time, and
I'll be very, very quick.
Okay, thank you.
These are our one-time requests. The $29 million I talked about, the three projects that were recommended by the governor are the Mineral Industries Building for School of Mines, Bioproducts Facility for SDSU, and the Dairy Unit for SDSU. I will tell you that the governor had recommended 2.75 for the Mineral Industries Building. Our bill for this is a little bit more. It's going to be about $4.4 million. The governor used a formula, her BFM used a formula in determining what the allocation would be for the general funds here, and there was actually a $7.8 million overrun on the Mineral Industries Building over what was authorized, and so because they were 56% generally funded in the original plan, we have 56% of that 7.8, so it's about $4.4 million. We had only asked for $4 million in our original request, not knowing there was going to be a formula, so that's why there's going to be a difference there. These are things that will be talked about by the campuses, some authority reductions and adjustments. This is the budget for the board office, the central office here in Pierre. This is kind of where does the money come from, and just kind of demonstrating for you that of our entire budget for the board office, which is a little over $91 million, about 39% of that is generally funded, 5% comes from the federal government, and then 56% is other funded. And so I've gotten that top part, what 56% is, or $49.5 million. Most of that is HEF, Higher Education Facility Fund. That is 11.5% of every tuition dollar comes to the system for facility maintenance and repair. Part of that goes to bonds, if we've bonded for major maintenance and repair projects, and the other goes directly to the campuses for them to do the maintenance and repair individually. We receive grants and contracts of a little over $7 million. We have charges within our system of about $10 million. We don't just do all the things for free. So we've got our IT people, our library, we have it called a Regents Library Consortium, where we're trying to offer some efficiencies through a library, and then some other funds for $2.7 million. So wanting to give you a bit of a breakdown so you understood what that was. The thing that is really important is that I always talk about the color of money, right? I can't use green money to pay for orange expenses. And so HEF, I can't use money that comes in as HEF dollars to pay for a teacher. I can't use money that comes in for the library consortium to pay for a researcher. I can't use a research dollar to pay for IT. And so these are really kind of those buckets, those colors of money, and it's really important that we stay within those buckets. What do we do with the money? So the money comes in and it has to go back out. What do we do with it? $32 million goes out to maintenance and repair. That is the largest component. So even though the money is utilized at the campuses, it routes through our office. So all of the maintenance and repair for all of the campuses routes through at that $32 million. We have bond payments of not quite $15 million. the Office of Executive Director for $13 million. I always get a little nervous. What do you mean we're spending $13 million? I think we're going to break that out for you a little bit more next year, in that we've got that library consortium pass-through grants. You heard about the Department of Ed grants from Dr. Minder earlier. Those are passing through there. That's a couple million dollars. We get some additional enrollment services, things that we do for students, and then academic initiatives of about $4 million. So the actual operations of our office are significantly less than the $13 million. And then we've got research and scholarships as well. That 8.5 includes the Opportunity Scholarship and any other scholarships that route from our office. Here's some information on Senator Boland.
Yeah, thank you. Question about the bond payments. During the Dugard administration, I know we paid off a lot of bonds. So what are these for, just generally speaking?
Madam Chair.
These bond payments, what projects, buildings?
Right. Again, I hate to just keep talking to you about the fact book.
Okay.
But we do have in the very
back. Tell me what page.
Pages 62, 63. 61, 62, and 63, we'll talk very specifically about every single campus, the date of the issuance, the principal outstanding,
etc. All I need to know. Thank you.
Okay. Maintenance and repair, again, this was our ask for $7.1 million to get us to 2% of replacement value. The governor's recommendation gets us up to the 1.75, which is consistent with what she's doing for other state agencies. This is the funding for maintenance and repair since fiscal year 08. I would just like to, again, thank the legislature and the rest of state government for their partnering with us in adding general fund maintenance and repair dollars. It's invaluable to our institutions. Opportunity scholarship here, you can see there has been a bit of a decline since about the 2019-2020 period. And we are anticipating there would probably be a reversion, but I believe there's a bill up to expand the dollar amount of the opportunity scholarship by a dollar without utilizing any additional general funds. So with the $6.1 million that we're receiving currently, we can continue to provide the opportunity scholarship at the advanced level. And then,
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With the increase in the Freedom Scholarship, Freedom Opportunity Scholarship, do you know where South Dakota now ranks regionally based on our needs-based scholarships and students Pell eligible? You know, we were pretty far down on the continuum, and we've made this investment. So have we come up? Do you guys have access to that data?
Madam Chair, are you talking about, so we don't have data yet for the Freedom Scholarship because it's so new.
Okay.
So I can't.
All right. Well, that's fine. Thank you.
Representative Van Huysen.
Ms. Forney, you said that bill would increase the opportunity scholarship by $1. I think you meant $1,000.
I'm sorry, I did mean $1,000.
Thank you.
Or a million, one something. It's going to, million. Right. And I think our final slide is just our office FTE utilization. You can see that our FTE budgeted increased to 33.5 in fiscal year 22. That was because we had some grants coming in and we weren't sure what we were going to need for FTE in there. We haven't needed those additional, so you'll see us in June come back and bump it back down to the 29 for our office because we just don't need those FTE. And then RIS is Regents Information System. That's the equivalent of BIT for our office. ESC is the Enrollment Services Center, which really helps students with things like transcripts and their when they apply for the common application, those kinds of things. And then RLC is the Regents Library Consortium. We have one person that helps really with the libraries across all the systems to try and maintain efficiencies. And then just, again, thank you. Thank you for everything that you've been doing for higher education, and thank you for all the work that you put in.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to move, but we're going to take a 10-minute break. We'll be back at 10:30, and we'll start with School for the Deaf and Visually Impaired.
Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net.
Okay, we're going to come out of recess, and we're going to be, this is a school for the deaf, is that correct? All right, welcome, and please identify yourself.
Yes, it is. Hello, Madam Chair. My name is Kim Wadsworth, and I'm superintendent at the South Dakota School for the Deaf. And my partner today is Claudine Lucky, and she's our business manager for the School for the Deaf and the School for the Blind. So I will let her begin.
All right. Madam Chair, again, my name is Claudine Lucky, and I am the business manager for the School for the Deaf. The first slide is going to touch on the base by fund source and just break it down for everyone. We are 86% general funds, 8% school and public lands, and 6% other. That other fund category breaks down to majority is lease payments paid to us by the South Dakota Department of Health and SDSU Extension. How do we spend our money? Well, 52% of that is spent on instructional, which is our outreach program. 21% is our student services, which is our audiology department. 16% is institutional support, which is basically our administration and business office. And 11% is operation and maintenance, which is our facilities. I'd refer you to page 82 of your budget brief. The governor did recommend a little over $37,000 in a decrease for utility payments, and that would be the only change in our budget for FY24. And the last slide I will be presenting today will be our FTE utilization. We are budgeted 26 FTE, and I'll refer you to the upper left-hand corner of our slide, which gets us to the total budget. We only utilized 21.46 this last fiscal year. However, if you look at what we have in the upper right-hand corner, we have filled a majority of our positions. We do have one that is left open currently, and that is an audiologist position. Otherwise, that gets us to our 26 FTE. And if you don't have any questions, I will move on to Superintendent Wadsworth's presentation.
There is a question, Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I remember when you came before us last year that you were struggling to fill these positions, and I believe the salary was the issue. Have we done a better job of attracting, and have the salaries increased to allow you to fill these positions?
Madam Chair, yes, we actually were able to fill these positions fairly quickly. We had some good applicants, and we were able to recruit fairly quickly.
All right. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
All right, Madam Chair. So SDSU is all state funded. It is comprised of our audiology department, our outreach department, and our external evaluations. You can see our website, sddeaf.org, and you can get all kinds of information about our services, about our boards, about our passionate and dedicated staff. You see our office locations are across the state right there, Hot Springs, Deadwood, Rapid City, Pierre, Aberdeen, Sioux Falls, and Madison. People think School for the Deaf is just Sioux Falls. It is across the state. We're a statewide outreach program. So how SDSD serves South Dakota, number one is supporting families and school districts. That's top. Collaborative consultation and training, professional development, educational and social activities across the state, student multidisciplinary evaluations, and our audiology screenings and evaluations. So SDSD, again, like I said, is statewide activities. So we were very fortunate that the Department of Education shared some money with us to develop deaf and hard of hearing training modules that we could share with all of our South Dakota educators in the state. We were thrilled about this. Our staff created 15 modules, so 15 hours worth of training, and so 200 South Dakota educators will have received a graduate credit paid for by the Department of Ed by June of 2023. 54 others received CEUs. We are funded by our foundation. Not all things can be paid for by the state when you're doing things with families across the state. So our SDSD Foundation has been instrumental in helping us to reach families and provide fun activities across the state. SDSD summer programs are, again, are funded by our SDSD general funds. We have our Hands in Motion summer program and our Just Communicate summer program. Looking into the future, that's always a big question, but South Dakota School for the Deaf is strong and growing. So, number one, collaborating with USD, and the Deaf Ed Minor Program. We were happy to see that pass this last year. I'm very excited, and we're working to support USD faculty and professors setting up presentations with this. The Ribbon of Service Partnership. I started that last year. It's a group of great variety of people and programs in our state, all that work with families who have deaf and hard of hearing children. This gets us in front of each other. We get to see each other's faces, get to know each other's programs more, learn from each other, ask questions of each other, and see where we need improvement. But again, working together to improve services for deaf and hard of hearing kids in our state. The SSD Advisory Council, that was reinstated 3 years ago. And it's worked really well to have a group that we meet regularly to talk about activities at the school for the deaf. Also, our subcommittee on our advisory council worked for over a year and a half on surveying constituents, stakeholders to find out, is a name revision necessary? Are we looking to do that? Is there any interest? And so currently there is Bill 37 in the legislature pertaining to revision of the name. There is steady growth, as I said, in students served, and it's a specialized skill set needed. Today, 612 students are on our rosters with varied hearing status, from one ear affected, unilateral, to profound. We also have the Midwest Conference on Deaf Education. So COVID hit, we kind of had to cancel that year, which was okay, but you know what? This June, we're going to have it again. We're so excited. We collaborate with the North Dakota School for the Deaf. It usually brings in over 150 deaf educators, administrators, speech therapists, interpreters from around the nation. And then new leadership at SDSD for the next year. So, like I said, after 35 years in deaf education, I've loved every minute. 26 years at the South Dakota School for the Deaf. I've just decided that it's time to retire. And I feel SDSD is strong, and I can just pass the baton, and we can keep moving forward. So we will continue as partners in educational success in all the school districts and homes in South Dakota. So thank you, and I stand by for questions.
Representative Van Huysen.
Ms. Weathers, first of all, congratulations on your retirement, and thank you for your years at the school. Can you elaborate a little bit on the name change, what the new proposed name is, and what your thinking is on that?
Madam Chairman, yes, thank you, Mr. Van Huysen. This bill simply changes the word school to services. We will still have the acronym SDSD. You will still have the logo that you saw here at the beginning of the presentation with the child hands up. So this will not affect any of our programs or activities. The name revision will better reflect and help to clarify our SDSD mission as we are on all outreach and audiology program in our state and going into homes and school districts. And as I said, SDSD is growing and strong. So again, look at our website to get more information. But it's just a minor one-word change. Thank you.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just, when I met you, how many years ago? Our sons played soccer together back in the day.
34, yeah.
Yeah, well, close. He's only 30. 34, so. Yeah, I don't think he was playing at infancy. But I just wanted to say thank you for all of your efforts and your hard work, and best of luck, and I think you'll enjoy retirement.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions? All right. Again, thank you. Thank you for your leadership. And as you said, the future will bring us a new person. And if you have any hands in helping to make that decision or recommendation, it'd be well worth it.
Great.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you for your time.
All
right.
Appreciate it. Next, School for the Visually Blind. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning. Dan Trev, Superintendent, South Dakota School for Blind, Visually Impaired. On my left is Business Manager Claudine Lucky. She does serve for both schools, so she will be sharing in this presentation as well. very soon we'll be celebrating our 123rd anniversary of the operation of the School for Blind, Visually Impaired in South Dakota and serving students in many different roles. This will be our fourth year of operation in the Aberdeen campus. So I will turn it over to Business Manager Lucky.
Good morning again, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Claudine Lucky, Business Manager for the School for the Blind and Visually Impaired. I will start off my presentation for the School for Blind and Visually Impaired again by demonstrating the fund source of the school. We just are just under $4 million in budget, and 88% of that is funded by general funds. We have 2% in federal, 3% in school and public lands, and 7% is other funds. Those other funds break down by out-of-state tuition. We currently do not have any students that come to us with out-of-state tuition and haven't for a few years now. Gifts and donations, food service, and other miscellaneous on-campus services, and then our summer school program. Where do we spend that money? Our expenditures by program. 60% is our instructional, which is our on-campus program as well as our outreach service program. 17% is our student services. That would include our residential program, our food service, and our nurse. 12% is our institutional support. Again, that's our administration, our business office, etc. 10% is our operations, which is our facilities, operation maintenance. 1% is our academic support. Now, academic support is simply our library. This slide would demonstrates where we spent our budget and where we went in the last 5 years for expenditures. I think it's important to point out that our instruction and our student support has grown in the last several years, and our institutional support has decreased. So we've tried to grow in our instructional area and in our student services area and find efficiencies in our administrative area. I refer you on to page 85 of the budget brief. The governor is recommending just over $4,400 increase for utilities this year, and that would be the only change to the budget that's being recommended. Whoops.
Okay. Next, I'll speak a little bit about our FTE utilization. This refers to FY22, the detailed information in the upper right of the slide. It's the difference between our current operation at 37.4 and our allocated 45.6. So currently we're looking for a science teacher, O&M instructor, that's orientation, mobility, teaching blind, visually impaired, cane skills, navigation, low vision specialist, transition specialist. We also utilize instructional assistants. Some people call them paras, same type of job description. Looking for those, we have filled 2.25 of those, so that's a very positive thing this year. 0.75 residential services professional. Those are the people that work in our dorms on a day-to-day basis in our residential area. And then 1.2 is utilized for pool positions, work study, substitute, summer school. We pull from that as well. So when you add the 8.2 on to the 37.4, comes to our full allocated FTE. So that's where we're currently operating at. I would say the challenges that we are presented with this year as well as in years past is a shortage of applicants for faculty positions, trained staff. Our faculty are required to get their teacher of the visually impaired endorsement, and so that's another layer of certification that is required to work at our school. We are an accredited school as well through the South Dakota Department of Education, so we do have to have highly qualified faculty in the areas of those curriculum specifics like science, math, English language arts, and so on. So those have been difficult to fill, as with other schools in the state of South Dakota, but we're working towards that.
We have a question. Senator Wick.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Do we have a program in any of our regental schools that teaches a visually impaired teacher?
Madam Chair, are you asking about the teacher of the visually impaired endorsement.
Thank you.
Is that Northern State University, which we work very, very closely with. We're across the street from them, which is very nice. We work together on a lot of different projects, and resources are shared, and that is one of the programs that they teach there. It's a certification. They also have a master's in special education that they are starting with emphasis in the teacher of the visually impaired. So people can move on and get that as well.
Just a question. Maybe I missed it. How many students do you have on campus now, living on campus?
Madam Chair. So our enrollment right now is at 24. Not all of those live on campus. Right now, I believe we have 4 in the dorms. The rest are day students. Our enrollment has changed as far as those numbers and who is in the dorms and who is actually in the area. When you look at the 24, about 70-80% are local area students. So they're either from the Aberdeen School District or area schools as well. We're seeing less and less of the far reaches applying for resident here.
So my follow-up will be, when we built this, because this is a new facility, how many beds or rooms did you have in the building to house residents?
Madam Chair, there are 20 dorm rooms, which could be double occupancy, and there are 2 apartments that we utilize for specialized training. So students will rotate into those apartments, rotate out, so we get a benefit of, they live on their own, they have their own bathroom, kitchen, bedroom, and so on. That's based on double occupancy. If you go 20 rooms times 2, that'd be 40. I think the challenge with that number is the staffing that you would need to truly to run it at that number.
One last follow-up. So when the planning went into that, was the anticipation that you would have the staff and you would have that many? I mean, if they're unoccupied now, what's the future here that we're looking at?
Madam Chair, I think the future and the challenge is each kid that makes application for attendance at the school brings kind of a level of standard of care that has to be addressed. If they're a one-on-one student that they require a person with them, it's hard to just put them into the mix and try and cover it with the personnel you have. I think that's a balancing act. And so depending on who makes application for to be in the school may change how it's managed going forward.
Led me to one last one. So do you have students that you can't accept because you don't have the staff resources to meet their needs in the example you just gave?
Madam Chair, there may be. So in the past, it's been an issue as well as, you know, if a student makes an application through their school district, we have to look at their IEP and what resources and needs they may have, and we may or may not have those, depending on their specialization and needs.
Representative Kasson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So I'm just curious, 24 students, is that the census? And then you said 4 living there full time. I guess my question then is, you know, Aberdeen isn't really centrally located. Are families moving there as a result of the services so that they get closer to your center so that they don't have to drive as far? Is that the reason why, you know, there's not more, you know, it seems like, you know, 20 students being close to there. Are we not, I guess then the other question is, are then we not serving the other students across the state, or are they just moving to closer to Aberdeen to be closer to you, if that makes sense?
Madam Chair, so the trend that we did see was, it's kind of started during the COVID years, where a lot of the out-of-state schools were closing and not opening. So some families made the decision to move to Aberdeen to be close to that. Recent trend is, yes, to move closer to that. One thought anecdotally is just, you know, to have your student home with you in the evenings. You think about the 6-7-year-old student that lives in the far reaches of the state. Are you willing to part with them, you know, 7 days a week or 5 days a week. I think that's a very hard decision. That's what we run into with the out-of-state tuition questions as well. Anecdotally, I've hosted some tours and entertained some school districts from North Dakota, and that's one of the difficult things that parents in school districts have with that placement is, you know, they're 6 and 7 years old. Are they going to place them away from their family? And then the cost in the end. As far as the far reaches, are we not serving them? We serve them with our outreach services, our consultants. We have 6 of them around the state. And so they go into the school districts to help those teachers and school personnel learn how to work with those students, provide resources, materials, things like that. And school districts somewhat are choosing to, you know, really take responsibility and work with their students in their districts and keep them at home. We're just not seeing the older students, high school student referrals like maybe they had years past.
Thank you.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So going back to budgeting by fund, it says other funding for the school is 7%. And then when you described that, I think you talked about food services, et cetera. And then on expenditures, student services is 17%. So I think that what's that is telling us is that the charge or the fees for your services is and the other funds that you're receiving don't pay for all of the services. Is that right?
Madam Chair, that is correct. That is correct. What I say when I say under other funds, when we charge for food service and other services on campus are very minimal charges. Teachers pay for if they eat on, basically their charges they pay for lunch on campus or if there's copies made in our copy room or things like that. But it's very minimal charge for a meal if a teacher decides to eat on campus, and it's not consistent. So we actually get general funds to operate our food service on a regular. Our students are not paying for their food. That is supplied by the state, and we do supply them 3 meals a day, 7 days a week. So the only ones that are charged for food service are if we have guests on campus, if we as administrators or teachers or faculty would like to eat on campus and so forth. So when I say miscellaneous services on campus, it's very minimal, that revenue.
Yes, thank you. So could you describe, or maybe we can go offline with it, but student services at 17% of your expenditures. Mm-hmm. So I've heard of copies and I've heard food service. So what other type of student services are reflected here in this 17%?
Madam Chair, so as far as expenditures for student services, our residential program runs through there as well. So residential services, so our professionals that work with the students in the dorm, any costs associated with the dorm program, our nurse would be something that falls through that student services. And then of course our kitchen staff and any food associated with running the food service program as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We just had the Board of Regents in here, and they have a program called Advantage, South Dakota Advantage, where out-of-state students can get in-state tuition. Does that apply to your school, too?
Madam Chair, it does not. We're under a different structure as far as what we charge for out-of-state students. It's done on a completely different basis. It's not where, if you're applying for a college, it would be done on a credit hour basis and what classes you take. We charge for across-the-board instruction is one of our columns, and then to provide the residential service, so for them to stay in our dorm.
Follow up?
Go ahead.
Can you give us some idea of the difference between an in-state student and an out-of-state student then with that change of fees? What would be the difference in cost? Approximately, you don't have to.
Right now, if our tuition for an out-of-state student is about $52,000 is what we would charge.
Thank you.
Go And to finish up here, this is our coverage. We have 6 outreach consultants across the state, Aberdeen, Brookings, Mitchell, Sioux Falls, Pier, and Spearfish. And again, they go out to the schools, go out to the homes. We serve students birth through 21. And those consultants help teach the parents, teach the teachers, the school district personnel how to work with that student, how to use accommodations in order to help that student access their education. You can see our student numbers about 232. School districts we work through is 89. Counties we're in is 48. And really our resource is free to people with inside the South Dakota boundaries, and we're very happy to do that. We'll stand by for any questions.
Thank you. Any questions? Okay. Thank you so very much, and thank you for the work you do. With that, did you have a question?
Is there any public testimony?
Okay. All right. I'm informed, I may ask you to be at ease for a minute here. Is there any public testimony regarding these two programs that were just presented? No public testimony? There is. Okay. No. Okay. Thank you. All right. Then we will move to our next group, and it looks like it's Black Hills State University. Good morning and welcome.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'm Lori Nichols. I serve as president of Black Hills State University. I do want to quickly introduce our new provost, John Kilpinen. And John, if you'd stand for a minute. John joined us in August, so he's in his first year. We're delighted to have him. Kathy Johnson, who's usually here with me, and many of you know Kathy, is home ill today. And so send her some good thoughts. I think she is with us virtually, though. So I told her if I get in a really tough question on budget, I might need to phone a friend. So Kathy, I think, is with us. And then I do believe Mary Ann Krogh, the dean of the College of Nursing at SDSU, may be with us virtually as well, in case there's a few questions on the West River Health Science Center. So let me just jump into this. I'm going to go through the first few slides really fast because I know we need to try to get back on track on time. But I do want to remind all of you that Black Hills State University is a public comprehensive regional university. And what that means is that we primarily focus on and serve Western South Dakota. And our focus is the Black Hills region. We're about access and affordability, and affordability is huge for us. We're about workforce alignment. We try to provide baccalaureate educated people into the workforce in Western South Dakota. And a very unique characteristic of a regional is that we have a lot of part-time students. 50% of our students are part-time. And in addition to that, we serve underserved students, lots of first-generation college students, low-income students, veterans. We also serve a large portion of Native American students. So just a little bit of uniqueness about a regional institution versus perhaps a land grant or a flagship or a specialty school. We did work last year, during the year of 21, on a new strategic plan for Black Hills State. We went live 2 weeks ago. It's called Climbing New Peaks, which we thought was really a great title for us. And it has 4 very large goals, one on students, one on our academic programs, one focusing more internally on employees, and then one on our marketing, branding, and identity as an institution. And the other thing I wanted to share with you is this is a big year for BH because this is our year for HLC accreditation, our 10-year accreditation review. Every 10 years, our regional accrediting body comes to campus and does a very in-depth look at us, and this is our year. So we are working on our self-study right now. It's due in March. That is our own work on studying ourselves, and then in April, a team of 5 from HLC will be on campus for about 3 days. Validating the self-study and really doing a thorough evaluation of us as an institution. So I would just say in April, send us very good vibes because we will be working on that as well. We were asked to share with you some information about our programs. And so this gives you a little bit of information at looking at programs in a few different ways.
The top is shows you our largest programs. So these are our large enrollment programs. All of this is using fall of 22 data. You can see by far our largest program is business administration. It's followed by elementary education at just a little under 200 students, and then tied for third are biology and exercise science, both at about 145 students. So those tend to be, you know, programs that bring in quite a few students to us. The three programs that are growing the fastest right now, right at the top, is our associate degree in applied health science. That is the program that we are working on, the West River Health Science Center and the nursing education in Rapid City. We targeted that program for high growth so that we could stand up the West River Health Science Center, and it is growing. So that's the good news there. We redid our communication studies program, another good growth program for us in biology. And then the last box is our programs that have declined the most over the last 3 years. And I just want to preface this by saying BH has lost enrollment overall as an institution, and these programs really track with the overall decrease in enrollment at BH. So psychology, elementary education, and business administration are the three that have lost the most, but I would say that's probably because they're some of our largest enrollment programs as well. And we're working on that too. We have enrollment plans behind each of those.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. President Nichols, is it that these students are not enrolling in this, or maybe they switched major? I'm just trying to understand this last statistic.
It primarily, Madam Chair, it is primarily because they're not coming in and enrolling in them. It's not so much of switching out. But we have lost over the last several years about 500 students at BH. And when you track it, it's natural that some of your larger enrollment programs would be down, because those are the programs that bring in the most students overall. So I mean, we're concerned about the loss in enrollment. I'm not so concerned about these programs. It's natural that they would lose some enrollment.
Just to go back to that, so business administration is your top three, but yet it's one of the programs that you're seeing a decline in the students.
Correct. Okay. All right. That would be, yes, that would be correct.
Senator Boland.
Thank you. As a result of the decline in enrollment, do you have a substantial amount of open spaces in dormitories?
Madam Chair, this year our dormitories were completely full. So, and part of that reason is because housing in Spearfish is so tight that it is almost impossible for our students to find apartments right now. And so many of them opted to come into the residence halls, even including juniors and seniors, which we have in the halls now, but our halls are really very full.
Okay. Thank you. That's good.
Senator Foster.
Chair, yes. Is this decline track to see if maybe you're losing some of the students to other institutions in the state, or if they're taking a semester off and not returning? Do you have any idea what is contributing to the decline, or where they go after they leave?
Madam Chair and Senator Foster, I think some of this is a result of less high school students going to college. That's something you've already talked about through the Board of Regents data. And I think some of it does have to do with students going to maybe two-year technical schools, which has become a bit more popular in the state than it was perhaps 5 or 10 years ago as well. Some of it's tied to affordability. There's a variety of factors.
Follow-up, with housing contribute to that, or do you see it being a disproportionate amount?
Madam Chair and Senator Foster, housing was a very big challenge for us this fall, and we did everything we could to make housing available to students, but I know that it was a barrier for us for sure.
Madam Chair.
Oh, Representative Kasson.
Yeah, just a quick question, Madam Chair, thank you. When we say students, we're talking about a combination of part-time and full-time students? Thank you.
We are.
Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. President Nichols, just trying to get a handle on these numbers here, and it's always dangerous to do math in public, but psychology, let's go to the top three programs that are in decline. 9% equals 40 students. Is that simple math there? But then if for simple math, that would mean you'd have almost 400 students in psychology for simple math, and it doesn't rank as the number one program.
Madam Chair and Representative Derby, I believe this is a three-year. So we looked at decline over 3 years.
Oh.
And so in some ways,
I think the math
is a little bit different because of the 3 years. Had we done a one-year decline, you would have been accurate on that. But the number of students actually that are in psychology, I think, is roughly around 100 that are in that major, if that helps you.
That helps a lot. Thank you.
Representative Carr.
Well, thank you, and good morning, President Nichols.
Good morning.
What's the overall attendance decrease? I like the micro analysis, but let's just back up into kind of more macro.
Right. Senator, Madam Chair, and Representative Carr, the overall enrollment at BH right now is 3,550 students. And I think if you go back 3 years ago, we would have been at about 3,800 students. So we've lost about 300 students over the last 3 years.
Follow up. So my question, I guess, is good analysis to really understand what's happening, but that loss, has that put any of your programs in jeopardy, or what's the consequences for the university? Any programming or, you know, bigger picture issues there?
Right. Senator or Madam Chair and Representative Carr, it has caused us to have to continue to decrease our budget at BH, and we have done that. And in fact, in a slide I have in a few minutes, I'll share with you that our budget went down from last year to this year $1.8 million, and that was a direct result of decrease in tuition over the last 2 years. So, yes, it has caused us to have to completely redo our budget, tighten up. We have eliminated roughly, I believe, 50 FTE on campus. So we're a much tighter, smaller, and I would say much more efficient campus now than we were maybe 3 years ago.
Follow-up? Do you have a plan to recapture some of these students? Is that coming up?
Yes. Can I go to that slide now?
Yep.
We have a question before then. Okay. Let's stay on track here. Representative Van Huysen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was just going to ask, and you may have a slide about this too, and then I can hold this, but just to speak a little bit about your base budget relative to the others and how that's been affected as well. But if that's coming up, I can hold that.
I would like to get to that in a minute if I could, because I will talk about our base budget in a second. What I'd like to do, though, is come back to the question about what are we doing about enrollment. It's of great concern, so I want you to know that it's something we're working very, very hard on. So to begin with, 2 years ago, we hired a national consulting firm called RNL to help us develop a comprehensive strategic enrollment plan for BH. It's very broad. It fully encompasses both recruitment and retention. And this shows you in broad categories what that plan looks like. As soon as the strategic enrollment plan was complete, we submitted a Title III grant to help fund this plan. And that was through the U.S. Department of Education. A Title III grant is called an institutional strengthening grant. And what it does is allows you to identify your weaknesses and then write a grant to begin to address and to improve in that area. We identified as enrollment as our weakness, and then our grant was written to that. We were funded at $2.5 million over 5 years, and we are in year two of both the strategic enrollment plan and the Title III grant. We are now hard at work on implementing the strategic enrollment plan and Title III across these broad areas. And I just shared with you a few of the action steps behind each of these areas, as well as the status on where we're at right now. And you can see that we right away got after recruitment and student success and financial aid, because we knew those three were so important to us, and we are making good progress there. This year, we started a teaching and learning center for faculty, so working with our faculty, especially around retention efforts, and then also doing work on the academic programs, and we are doing a lot of that through our HLC accreditation, aligning academic programs to workforce needs and things of that nature. And then last thing we will work on is analytics, and that's yet to come. But early indicators are it is working, because we were up 6% in incoming freshmen this fall, and we have improved our retention 10% from low 60s to low 70s. So we do have some good early indicators from this work that we're doing right now. So that is a biggie on what we're doing, is that we really have a very good plan in place.
The next thing I wanted to share with you is what we're doing on scholarships, because affordability is huge to us. And the reason it is because so many of our students are Pell eligible. 34% of the students are BH are eligible for a Pell grant. And that is one out of every three students. And remember, Pell is highest financial need. So these students are really needy when we talk about them qualifying. So we know the pressure is on us to do as much as we can for scholarships. And here, I just show you on this slide a couple of things. On the left side, you'll see what the overall foundation raised. We had a really rough year in COVID, as you can see, but the last 2 years have been phenomenal and have broken institutional records both years. This year, we came in just right under $20 million in fundraising for the year, which is a record at BH. And then on the right, it shows you our scholarship awards. So how do we track in terms of awarding scholarships? And you can see, even though the foundation fundraising has been a little up and down, we have been increasing every year in scholarships. And this year, we awarded $2.3 million in scholarships. And that's directly from our foundation out to our students. Our goal is to get to $3 million. And we are about to enter into a capital campaign to try to accelerate that and get our scholarship program growing and up to our goal as well. I do want to just say one other thing about this, and that is that BH is by far the highest institution in the state for Pell eligible students. We're 10% above almost any other institution except Northern. Northern is about 5% behind us, and every other institution is about 10. So we really do have some very financial needy students at BH, and it does present a different dynamic in terms of retention and making sure that those students come to us and stay with us for a degree.
Senator Maher.
So on that 19.8 million, so what does that take your foundation budget total to then? What do you, I mean, if you raise 19.8 in 1 year and you're giving on approximately 2.3, what's your overall fund balance?
The overall endowment is 32 million at the foundation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. President Nichols, did you say that about 50% of your students are part-time?
That would be correct, yes.
Yeah. And so the question would be, is are large percentage of those part-time students the Pell eligibles, or is that a like-for-like?
Madam Chair, yes, it is true that many of our part-time students are Pell eligible, and of course then they get a reduced award if they're going part-time.
Sure. Thank you.
Senator Wink.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think you're in the past, anyhow, you've gotten quite a few students from Wyoming and Montana. Is that still the case? And are those two states taking any actions at their legislative level to make it to where they're trying to keep their students and make it more competitive for you to get them?
Right. And I think my next slide goes into that. Oh. So let me just share with you, very well anticipated, by the way. So let me just share with you a little bit about the Dakota Advantage. You saw Heather Forney presented that information to you from a system perspective, but now I'll share it to you what it looks like for BH. So here you can see what enrollment looks like over 4 years. That program started fall of 19, and I share it with you each year so you can see that growth. Overall, we've grown in students from Colorado, Nebraska, and Wyoming by 61% in those 4 years. By far the biggest state for us is Wyoming, where we've grown by 89%. But Colorado has become a really good state for us, and it's become a key recruitment state because we're up 42% there as well. So if you ask about, is the Dakota Advantage working for us, it's working terrific, and it's working especially well in those three states. When we get away from those three and we go to things like North Dakota, Minnesota, Iowa, we don't recruit as many students because we're a regional public and our focus is on Western South Dakota. So we really see these three as being key. We do work in Montana a little. We've had less success there because Montana tuition is low. So many of those students stay in state to go to school. Are other states doing this? To my knowledge, at this point in time, I do not believe Wyoming or Colorado are putting in place an in-state tuition program for students from South Dakota that I'm aware of. I also wanted to share one other strategy with you too, and that is that we have really worked, and I have to say this has been a lot of work the last 2 years in particular, but we've really worked to try to form regional partnerships so that we can grow enrollment. Enrollment growth is a key behind this. And I list for you what I consider to be some of our most exciting new partnerships. A couple of those are older as well, but several of those are brand new. And all of these have enrollment behind them in one way or another. I'm actually going to come back and talk about the West River Health Science Center in just a minute. I have a separate slide on that. But I think you all know a year ago we went into Ellsworth Air Force Base. We were one of two universities approved to open a campus there, which simply means open an office, have a classroom, and start offering classes. We have 40 active military now enrolled at BH that were not enrolled there a year ago. So this would be new enrollment to us. It's modest, but we really hope that over time that enrollment can continue to grow. So we see Ellsworth as a really important partnership for us in the future. We signed an MOU with Crazy Horse, which is an incoming freshman program for Native American students all over the country who come to Crazy Horse and do some early enrollment classes as well as work at Crazy Horse. It's really a wonderful program. I could go through all of these, and I won't, but you can see that we're working across the board on partnerships so that we can support our students and so that we can see enrollment growth over time. And let me just go into a couple of these in a little bit more detail. I know, Senator Hunhoff, you in particular asked if we would talk for a minute about the West River Health Science Center, and so I do want to do that. Let me start by saying Black Hills State has been active in Rapid City for decades, probably 40 to 50 years. Currently, we do own a facility. It is 12 years old. It's located on the far east side of Rapid, right on I-90, exit 60. Senate Bill 55 was a really big deal for our Rapid City campus because they gave us a number of recommendations, which we are implementing. The first is that we would repurpose the Black Hills State University Rapid City Center to have much more of a health science focus. Another was that we would go to one nursing program, and SDSU nursing program is the program that's continuing there. A third is that we would move the nursing program from their current facility, kind of more downtown Rapid City, out to our facility, which is the one located out on Cheyenne Boulevard. And so those are the recommendations we're busy on implementing right now. To accomplish this, we needed to do a renovation of about 10,000 square feet of our current facility, and then we needed to build a wing for the nursing program, and it's about a 34,000 square foot wing. Last year, we presented to you a budget of $15 million so that we could do this. You approve of that, we ask you for $8 million to support through the state, and then the remainder came from HEF funding and a $2 million gift from Monument, which we have realized they have committed $2 million to this project. I also want to, for those of you that are new and didn't hear our presentation last year on this, the West River Health Science Center is an academic center that brings, it's a 2+2 program that brings Black Hills State University together with South Dakota State University's nursing program. We do the first 2 years in a pre-nursing curriculum. We hand them off seamlessly to SDSU, who does the last 2 years in a BSN nursing program in Rapid City in their West River nursing program. The West River Health Science Center helps grow. I mean, marketing and recruitment is a huge part of it. So bringing students into the nursing program is a big effort. We also make sure we articulate all credits. We have student support, and we have pathway programs with transfers from technical schools and so forth. We are working really hard right now to get to 100 new students admitted every year into the Applied Health Science program. And remember, I just told you that's one of our fastest growing majors right now. So we are starting to see some real enrollment growth in that program. It's key because it's the pipeline program into the nursing. So if we don't see growth there, they're going to have a hard time growing the nursing program as well. Just to give you a little indicator, we're at 73 right now, new students into the program, and we want to be at 100. And one other little number I'll throw out is our spring numbers. We just started classes 2 weeks ago, And a year ago, we brought in about 10 new students into this major. Just two weeks ago, we brought 20 new students into this major. So I want to just tell you that while we're not there yet, we are starting to see some growth, and I think that's an early promising sign. So our goal is 100 new students in applied health science, and then SDSU nursing is now approved for 72 students per class, and they have five classes because they're a five-semester program, and they're at about 50 to 55. So they're working on growth right alongside us working on growth as well. And I hope that answers some questions about just kind of where we're at right now with implementing the West River Health Science Center. I want to go on and also say one other thing Senate Bill 55 asks us to do, and again, we're working away at this, is to find as many efficiencies between Black Hill State and School of Mines as we possibly could. And that was really the charge, is work on it, but there wasn't anything more specific around it. But I do want to tell you what we've done so far, because we're really actually proud of this, and I think President Rankin is also planning to talk about this tomorrow. We have combined forces in several areas under finance and administration. So the School of Mines now is going to run all administration around travel. So they're going to do travel audits, travel reimbursement. They're running all travel for both institutions. We aren't going to do that at BH anymore. Mines is also doing all purchasing for the two systems. So we put a requisition in for purchasing. They do the work, get the order out, get the product in. We're at BH, we're not going to do that anymore. Mines will handle that for both institutions. BH is running all campus cards. So we have a Buzz card, they have a Hard Rocker card, everything's loaded on those cards, faculty have cards. We run all card services for both institutions right now. And we're working on IT collaboration as a next step on what we can do together. We together have hired or are hiring a sustainability coordinator. That will be a person who will work on energy utilization on our two campuses. We have a very big solar program at BH. Mines would like to mimic that and do more with solar, and we think we have expertise to share with them. So there's a combination there. And finally, we have decided to merge our HR director. We have one HR director who serves HR at both campuses. So you can see that we're really working toward trying to be more efficient with business functions and what I kind of call back of the house. These are not student-facing things. These are things that we do to run a university. And we think that we will be able to be much more efficient as we move forward there, which has helped us as we've had to reduce our budget when we can see efficiencies in areas such as this.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So how will you measure the efficiency other than, I know it's going to be a dollar bill, but where are you at in measuring it? Do you have any benchmarks? Do you have any numbers yet?
Madam Chair and Senator Johnson, we really don't. We're in year one of doing this. Okay. So our benchmark would be, what were we spending prior to starting the effort to work together? So we know what, I know what BH was spending. I know Mines knows what they were spending. And as we move forward, of course, what we're trying to do is reduce expenditures without reducing services. Senator Wink.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Can you bring us up to date on what's happening? I know that that's always been a teacher training has been a major part of yours. What's happening with your numbers? Is it following kind of nationwide? It seems like it's everybody's having a hard time trying to find teachers. And can you bring us up to date on your numbers?
Madam Chair and Senator Wink, we are right now struggling with enrollment in education. It is true, and you saw that it's one of elementary ed is one of our programs that has declined, and it's. You know, not what we want to see, because that is very much a foundational program for us, but we are following national trends. Nationally, I would say every state is struggling right now with enrolling people into teacher ed. And I think in South Dakota, we struggle more because we do tend to have a lower salary base for our teachers. So we produce a lot of teachers at BH, but I will tell you, many of them go right across the state line to Wyoming, where they're earning easily $10,000 a year right off the bat. So it's hard to retain them when you're so close to a couple of other states that pay quite a bit better.
Thank you.
Question. Senator Boland.
Thank you. Does Black Hills have any direct involvement with the underground mine? Can you maybe just let us know a little bit about that, too? Thank you.
Yes.
Madam Chair. We do. We've had a longstanding relationship with SURF, the Sanford Underground Research Facility, and the two things that we do there, one is we have a lab underground at the 4,200-foot level, and our lab is a service lab. So while Berkeley and others have research labs where they're doing very cutting-edge research, BH has a service lab, and we partner with every other research project down there, and we count neutrinos for them. So our service is counting neutrinos because they don't want to mess around with that. They have other things they need to do. They subcontract that to us, and then we have these big machines that count neutrinos, and we provide that data back to them on a daily basis as they need the data. So we run that facility. And then the other thing we have is a very strong partnership with their education and outreach, and that is the whole K-12 teacher education or teacher in service that they do. And we really work hand in glove with them on that. And in fact, when they hire four individuals in science education to do that, they're actually BH employees. So there are employees, but then we contract them to the lab, and then they do the work at the lab. So it's a tight partnership that we've had for quite a long time.
Thank you.
I have a question, Madam Chair.
Senator Johnson.
So you mentioned earlier that teachers who graduate go instantly to Wyoming, cross the border, which is not that far away from campus. And then you said an increase immediately 10,000. Are you talking about 10,000 per year over the annual rate, right?
Madam Chair, I am talking 10,000 per year beginning. This would be their first contract.
Yeah, okay. So that, thank you for the clarification of that. And then do you know if Wyoming has the same shortage of teachers as South Dakota or the rest of the nation?
Madam Chair and Senator Johnson, I am not up to date right now on how Wyoming is doing with their teacher shortage. I can tell you about 4 years ago, they had some teacher shortage, nothing as dire as South Dakota. I have a couple of slides I want to conclude with. One is our budget slide, and I just have a couple things I want to point out. One is our overall budget is $42.3 million, and you can see where our money comes from. 45% from tuition, 28% comes from the general fund or the appropriation that you give to the Board of Regents. I don't know if this is Representative Van Huysen. I almost called you Regent Van Huysen. I'm sorry. I don't know if this is what you were after, but I think some of the study that is going on right now is looking at that general fund allocation that comes to the Board of Regents and then goes out to the six institutions. And BH has historically been very low on that general fund allocation. And even to this day, that would be true, that we receive a lesser percentage than some of the other institutions.
Representative Van Huysen.
Thank you, and this might be a question for Ms. Forney, too. I think the regents submitted something to the former Appropriations Committee late last year in response to a question or a letter of intent or something, and so would one of you just speak briefly to that for the pretty sizable number of new committee members on this committee?
Madam Chair, Heather Forney, Vice President for Finance at the Board of Regents. I was supposed to just be here to move slides forward, but there was a letter of intent issued by this committee which required the Board of Regents to review and analyze the general fund allocation to each of our institutions and provide a report back to you by December 1st of 2022 and again by December 1st of 2023 with the intention that we would have some type of a reallocation or redistribution for our fiscal year 25 budgets, which would be next year. We did present that via Teams because it was the middle of a lovely snowstorm here in the God's country, and the essentially what we had determined through this is something we've been working on for years was kind of a twofold: what do tuition fees look like for revenue, and what does our general fund allocation look like? And we decided, you know, as we were looking a possible redistribution, that in every single scenario, we had three campuses that would see a significant reallocation of general funds to them, and we had three campuses that would see a significant reallocation of general funds away from the institutions. And when I say significant, I mean we're talking millions of dollars. So then we thought, well, you know, that's just trying to reallocate the pie that we have. Is the pie the right size? So we went back and did some analysis and compared the academic costs, how much it costs us to provide academic services at our institutions. And we benchmarked the kinds of programs we offer against what's called the Delaware Cost Study, which is what does it cost to provide those same programs across over 120 different institutions in the nation. And so we could come up with what should we be spending on the academic component of our campuses. And then we also looked at the administrative component. So how much does it cost us to provide administration? So presidents, financial aid, any kind of service to the student. And so that would have given you total cost. And we benchmarked that against a consortium that we belong to called Helio Campus, just to verify and validate that what we're spending in administration isn't completely out of whack. We're not spending significantly more than anyone else. And we were on par with our peers in those scenarios. So what we came up with was this is essentially what it should cost us to provide services at our institutions. And then we looked at our revenue sources, and we know that's really two main sources, which is general funds and tuition and fees. The grants and those kinds of things have to be spent in that part, and that wasn't really something we were looking at. So what do we generate for tuition and fees? And then on top of that, what do we receive in general funds? And so we compared our revenue sources to what it should cost us to provide services compared to our peers and marked them against each other. And what that told us is, as a system, we're behind our peers for revenue generation compared to cost. School of Mines is pretty close to their peers. They're within $100,000. But what we saw was Black Hills State University is like in 78%. 75% of their peers. So they receive 25% less revenue than they should to offer the kinds of services that they do for their degree programs and their size of institution. And there were varying degrees between that 75 being BH at the lowest and School of Mines, which is really within the margin of their peers. There is a written, Madam Chair, there's a written report on that. We submitted it to the Joint Committee on Appropriations in our letter of intent. There are a couple of tables on the very last page that kind of map out what that looks like across all of the institutions.
Thank you. We can get that sent out and put on the binder. Representative Van Huysen.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. And thank you for sharing that. I mean, we're used to in this committee hearing people who say they're not at 100% of where they want to be. That's a pretty typical. But I think it's important to understand across the six universities where they are relative to each other. That's why I brought it up. And as you said, Madam Chair, if our staff could distribute that to the new committee members, that'd be great. Thank you.
I will continue on and just simply say on the budget slide here, you will see that we've reduced our budget and FTE utilization, and that is due directly to the enrollment decline that we've been talking about all along today. We do have a balanced budget at BH, and one thing that I'm going to say that I'm really proud of, because this has been hard work, is that while we were decreasing our budget and making sure we had a balanced budget each year, we also had to rebuild a reserve fund that had gotten dangerously low, and we are back to a good solid $5.2 million reserve. So we've rebuilt a reserve fund while we've been decreasing the budget too. It's been tough work these last couple of years, but I think we're getting to a point where we're getting pretty solid. I'm glad we're where we're at because of the HLC visit this year. And then I have two last slides, and I'm going to just say this next one is a big thank you slide. This is the, since I've been here, this is the support you have given us through the legislature, and particularly through joint appropriations. We did a beautiful library remodel, and by the way, if you ever are on BH, I would just love to take you through it and show it to you. It's lovely. But we got authority from you to do that. That was paid for through M&R primarily. Thank you for the Freedom Scholarship. We awarded $470,000 in Freedom Scholarship to 90 students, and that was right at about $5,000 per student. So that is a great program, and it is making a difference. And then we have a number of projects, and I just want to say thank you, Senator Maher, for carrying the bill on these, the Bloomberg Terminal, the Communications Program, the the science education program funding, small amounts of money, but they helped us move some of those programs forward. And then I've already mentioned the $8 million from the West River Health Science Center, and that's the building project that we're working on. And my last slide is just our budget request this year. Of course, the tuition freeze is front and center. Our share of that is a little over $900,000 so that we could freeze tuition at BH and not yet give our employees a 5% salary increase. We do know we're short on the construction of the West River Health Science Center, and right now our projections are $4.5 million, and we're refining that number as we speak. We have both the architects and the contractor working on that. We'll have a better number soon. The cybersecurity upgrade will include a new firewall for, I think, all of us, but I can tell you at BH it's really needed. And then Heather talked about the $32.6 million M&R project, and I think some of you said, well, we see a breakdown, and I'll just share with you quickly, the breakdown at BH is that we would like to take an old daycare facility, do a renovation into a laboratory preschool for our elementary education and early childhood education program, just about $2 million for that. And then our Woodburn Theater, which is an old historic theater in Woodburn Hall, one of the oldest buildings on campus, is in dire need of an upgrade, and that's about $4 million. And we'd be able to upgrade the whole facility with that amount of money. So those are our two M&R projects that we're pushing forward.
Thank you.
With that, I am done, and I would stand for any other questions.
Senator Boland.
One question. So I just want to make sure now. So the legislature appropriated $8 million some dollars for the Health Science Center, West River, and now you're going to need another $4.5 million to complete the project. So we're looking at essentially a 50% cost overrun. Is that accurate?
Madam Chair and Senator Boland, the overall project is $15.1 million, and it included funding sources from three places.
Okay.
The state, $8 million. HEF, which was $5.1 million, and Monument Health, who gave us a $2 million gift towards it. That's how we got to 15.1. Now we're looking at about a 30% cost overrun. It's 25 to 30% cost overrun of the total 15.1 million, and that's where the 4.5 comes from.
That's still a substantial amount of money.
Yeah, it is.
Thank you.
Senator Maher.
I have a couple questions. Just to follow up where Senator Boland was, I thought you were waiting for some federal approval, too. And that was what? How much?
Madam Chair, Heather Forney, Vice President for Finance and Administration for the Board. So the state funding that President Nichols mentioned was actually funded through the federal ARPA funds, as well as the Northern Lincoln Hall project. I think you've got a couple projects from maybe Department of Corrections and Department of Health. Those were all federal dollars. So the $8 million we'd asked for state funding was actually approved to utilize construction funds through ARPA. And we are in the process of waiting for a response on that. I think my friends at BFM are sick of me asking where we're at. But we've submitted all of the data and the information within the information within the required time frame. And the last I heard, which was late last week, is that they're reviewing Treasury is way behind I think where they had planned to be at this point in time, and may have hired some extra folks to help them with applications. But we are waiting for federal authorization. And to that point, we've kind of forced BH to hold off on any renovations to West River Health Science, and we forced Northern to hold off on doing the Lincoln Hall project until we know that we've gotten the green light for those funds from the feds.
So then another question, this is unrelated to the renovation center, but at one time you were starting a new program in forestry and you were getting some money from, is it Nauman?
Nyman.
Mm-hmm. And how is that turning out, and are those students coming into that program? And he was going to fund that, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. Madam Chair and Senator Maher, that we started a new forestry program a year ago, so we're about a year and a half into it now. Jim Nyman of Nyman Enterprises provided the first 3 years startup funding for it, and that included a faculty member and then also scholarships so that we could recruit students into it. The faculty member is here, started in the fall, and is doing great, came from Virginia Tech, and so we have our first faculty member in forestry. And we have, I'm going to say 15 students in the major. It may actually be 12, but we're in that 12 to 15 range that we've admitted into the major now.
Thank you. Any other questions? Thank you for responding to our time request. You covered greatly, and there's always potential for questions, which we all follow up on. So
thank you.
Thank you. Next, I have Dakota State University. It's still morning, so I can say good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair and members of the committee. I'm Jose Marie Griffiths, the president at Dakota State University. I'm accompanied by Stacey Cruzmark, DSU's Vice President for Business and Administrative Services. And we also have our provost, Rebecca Hoy, online. She was under the weather also and unable to join us physically today. DSU's mission, DSU's mission has evolved over time. Established in 1881 to educate teachers in the Dakota Territories, we were the first teacher preparation institution in what became the state of South Dakota. We refer to this original mission as our heritage mission. In 1984, under the then leadership of Governor Janklow, our mission was changed to the current statutory mission. It designated Dakota State University as an institution that offers education related to computer and information systems, electronic data systems, and related programs. At the same time, retaining our heritage mission, but adding an emphasis on educational technologies. This past year, the Board of Regents worked with us to refine the institutional mission policy. Our current operational mission designates DSU as a special focus university. And special focus universities have a high concentration of degrees in a single field or set of related fields. You might understand a School of Mines is the other special focus university. DSU's special focus is computing and information technologies and cybersecurity. And we've been designated the leader in these areas for the state of South Dakota and a recognized leader across the United States. The areas covered by this mission statement, computing and information systems, are increasingly referred to as cyber. While many think this is new terminology, the term was actually first created in 1948 and has become the collective term defining all things associated with computers, networks, data processing, information systems, etc. And cybersecurity is just one area within the broader concept of cyber. So I mention this because we consider ourselves a cyber university. All the degrees we offer are cyber degrees. Some are what we would say cyber intensive, like computer science, cyber operations, information systems, and others are cyber infused, like elementary education, biology, English for new media, etc. Just wanted to give you that because when we talk about cyber, everybody thinks we're talking about cybersecurity, and we're not. When we're talking about cybersecurity, we'll say cybersecurity. Our enrollments have continued along an upward trajectory. You can see a dip associated with the COVID pandemic and the transition of our respiratory care program to SDSU, which was over a 2-year period. But we are recovering from those events. Our top three programs, in terms of total enrollments, reflect our signature and heritage missions. Our largest program is the BS in Cyber Operations. And for those of you unfamiliar with that term, it refers to offensive cybersecurity, the kinds of things that the NSA and Department of Defense are engaged in. And this is followed by our computer science BS, and these two programs account for almost half of our enrollments. The third largest program is the BS Ed in elementary education. Our top three programs for growth in terms of the number of students actually include two graduate programs and one undergraduate. Artificial intelligence is our new program, just now in its second year, and we anticipate that it's going to continue to grow in the foreseeable future. But given that we've got the two the two graduate programs there, if I give you the additional two undergraduate programs you might be interested in, after artificial intelligence, the next largest growth program is cyber leadership and intelligence, which is actually offered out of our College of Arts and Sciences, and that's a relatively new program, followed by elementary ed. So I just wanted you to know that our elementary ed program is growing. The programs with the largest decline in number of students are elementary special ed, and that's partly because elementary special ed is a dual major, and so you have to take 142 credits for that degree rather than the 120 credits for elementary education. Those two tend to be reciprocal, so we saw a growth in one and a decline in the other, and we suspect with the teacher shortage, a lot of our students are opting to go into the elementary education degree, get that degree, get the job. Most of them, by the way, stay in South Dakota, and then can take the special education courses later should they wish to do so. So it is, special ed is a bigger decline. And then our data analytics masters and our cyber operations, which is our largest program, also saw a decline. And that's because we rarely see a program just continue up a linear trajectory. They tend to go up a bit, down a bit, up a bit, down a bit. It's the way you see these programs evolve over time. If I put our biggest decline by percentage drop, it would be respiratory care, because it went from, originally 50-odd students down to zero during a period of time. So we put it in by the numbers, because percentage changes can be a bit unhelpful. I didn't include our Bachelor of Business Administration in finance, business technology, marketing, management, and accounting. We restructured the BBA degree last year. We eliminated five majors that would have shown rapid decline in those, and you'd seen a rapid increase in the Bachelor of Business Administration general degree, because those students would go now into the general degree and get a specialization in those areas where before we had offered freestanding degrees in those programs. We made similar adjustments to our degrees in English, mathematics, and biology. So I didn't show those. We have been taking those low enrollment programs and gradually eliminating them.
I have a question. You just described a basic program. You said a bachelor's in computer science or was going down. I'm sorry. I'm trying to connect the dots.
We have one of our degree programs that's one of the fastest declining is cyber operations at the undergraduate level.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But then you talked about your business programs growing. Mm-hmm. Is your curriculum different than what we have at Black Hills State and what the university has in their business programs?
Well, what we did was we took the specialization, we took the degrees. You could get a degree in marketing before now, and you could get a degree in management. We've eliminated those. Now you can get a degree in business with a specialization in marketing, or a degree in business with a specialization in management. So that's what we took. I don't know exactly what Black Hills or USD is doing. We took our low enrollment programs and consolidated them, basically. We have good news in the retention rates for our full-time, first-time degree-seeking bachelor's degree students, and there we have a sort of clear trajectory upwards. We're currently aiming for 80% overall from the current almost 75%, but I think it's worth noting that the Beacom College of Computer and Cyber Sciences has almost reached 85% retention rate and is now looking to improve to 90%. Our job placement measures the proportion of graduates who have a job related to their major field of study within 6 months of graduation, and our results have been holding steady at 99% overall. And it's also worth noting that our placement rate is based on a 95% plus response rate, making that 99% estimate very, very solid number, plus or minus less than a percent. Another indicator of the quality of our education and the success of our students is Dakota State's representation on the U.S. cyber team to compete in what have been called the Olympics of cybersecurity. Note that these competitions are akin to war games. It's not kids just playing games. They really are war games. In 2022, the first international cyber games were held in Athens, Greece, and a subsequent competition between the U.S. and Europe was held in Vienna. Last year, more than 800 students and recent graduates around the United States tried out for the travel team of 20. We had four selected for the team and one in the pipeline program. This year, with more than 1,300 trying out, we have four on the travel team and one in the pipeline program. And then we have an alumnus trainer who was one of our competitors last year. They will compete this year in San Diego and Norway. And I can tell you that in Washington, D.C., some people are saying what's in the water in Madison, South Dakota. We have great students and great faculty. Last year, I'm pleased to say, we were engaged in our accreditation process with the Higher Learning Commission. This is not the full tenure. We had done that a few years ago. But we had our first assurance review under a totally new process. We had to produce a lot of evidence, and a lot of institutions fail on their ability to produce evidence of what they actually say they have done. But I'm pleased to say we were completely successful with no ongoing monitoring required. So that was a good effort that everybody was involved in.
Madam Chair.
Sorry. Chair Johnson.
Thank you. Is your accreditation, is HLC accreditation statewide, or is it just to your category of?
No, HLC accreditation is a regional accrediting body, but ours, each institution is accredited independently.
By HLC?
It depends what region of the country, but in this part of the country, we're all HLC accredited. In the southeast, it's the SACS, southeast, and in northeast, it's NEASC. There are a number of regional accreditors around the country authorized by the U.S. Department of Education.
Are there multiple accreditations that you seek for?
There are two types of accreditation. The regional accreditation accredits the whole, excuse me, Madam Chair, I apologize. This is always my problem, you know that. They accredit the university, and they basically say, yes, this is a good institution, and the degree programs that they have are valid and appropriate. Then there's specialized accreditation, which is disciplinary education. Mm-hmm. So we have some of each. Most institutions would have some of each.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. On to South Dakota Advantage. Our South Dakota Advantage grew by 225% between 2018 and 2023. The largest portion of South Dakota Advantage students are from Iowa, Nebraska, and Colorado. Not surprisingly, they're sort of the closest ones. Our top enrollment programs for South Dakota Advantage students are cyber operations, computer science, and computer game design, followed actually by exercise science. I thought it was quite interesting. So South Dakota Advantage brought us additional enrollments. I think our return on investment number was 2 when we first put in our return on investment numbers. These enrollments generate additional revenues, which can be used for services that actually benefit all students. Adding students from other states increases opportunities for new perspectives, ideas, research collaborations, and we hope will encourage those students to stay and work in South Dakota. Now, in last year's legislative session, you passed SB 54, and we're especially thankful to you for that. This legislation was for a special appropriation of $30 million for DSU to increase its capacity to double the number of cyber graduates in specific degree programs to work in our applied research lab, conducting cyber research for government agencies and contractors, thereby contributing to national security and defense, as well as the state's economy. Now, just to explain what those specific degree programs are. In the cybersecurity world, we have defensive cybersecurity, which includes network security, cyber defense, digital forensics. And we have offensive cybersecurity, which is called cyber operations, because nobody wants to acknowledge we have offensive cybersecurity, but we do. Cyber operations is heavily intertwined with computer science. Computer science is a strong foundation. And then artificial intelligence will increasingly be used for cyber operations because there's so much data coming in that we have to analyze. So in 2021, DSU had just under 200 students graduating in cyber operations, computer science, and artificial intelligence. So in our proposal to grow our applied research lab in both Madison and Sioux Falls, we proposed increasing our capacity to double the number of those graduates from 200 to 400. So it is a specific set of programs. We're always looking to increase the size of all of our programs, but the research dollars, the dollars that we received last year, are heavily slanted towards those three programs. Now, SB 54 included three areas of effort to accomplish this goal, each with funding of $10 million. There was faculty recruitment and retention, student recruitment and retention, and pipeline development through the Governor's Cyber Academy, and I'm going to give you a brief update on what's happened so far. In the recruitment and retention of faculty, we've been successful in fending off a raid last summer from a competitor university. We retained 5 of 7 cyber operations faculty, so these are core faculty in that core area. We lost one to the competitor. The other one went to Google, which we think is a positive. It's always good to have an advocate within Google. We initiated searches for multiple faculty, not just for the Beacon College, but also for the College of Arts and Sciences, because they will teach the general education classes needed by the increasing Beacon College students. So if we increase students in any other college, we have to increase the number of faculty eventually who teach general education courses to those students. But as of today, we have hired, or in the final stages of hiring, 6 full-time faculty and instructors and 8 adjunct faculty for Beacon College. The arts and sciences searches are at the interviewing stage, and our searches will continue. We have geared up our search process. It used to take forever, you know, academic institutions to get one search completed. It used to take at least a semester. We've sped it up to move very quickly so that when we identify qualified people that want to come, we can hire them quickly. And we've been working with Kayla Bastian in the board's office on that process. In the area of student recruitment and retention, we've hired 2 graduate enrollment counselors. We've subscribed and started to use software that increases student engagement and improves retention. We're now recruiting for new staff positions, a transfer specialist, an admissions counselor, and we've partnered with an enrollment partner, Niche, or Niche, to expand our prospect list from the Midwest region to across the United States. So we'll now have access to information about high school students across the United States who are aiming to study computer science and cybersecurity, and we'll be able to go out and market to them and attempt to recruit them. We're intensifying those marketing efforts in the region and expanding to major areas across the country, including the Washington, D.C. metro area, Texas, California, places where there are high concentration of cyber professionals and where there's a university offering a doctorate in cyber operations, because we hope to attract their graduates. The third area for SB 55 was to launch the Governor's Cyber Academy. We've hired a dean who started this month, Phoenicia Homan. She just started. We're in the final stages of hiring an instructional designer to help design what we're calling master courses that will give the students a consistent design and format, and facilitating qualified high school teachers, mostly graduates of DSU, I should say, and adjunct faculty to teach the classes in addition to our own faculty. And now we're developing a detailed plan with budget and revenue projections for the Cyber Academy.
Senator Foster.
You mentioned that you were training high school teachers. Is that to teach high school students, or is...
Yes. Sorry, the Cyber Academy is for high school juniors and seniors to earn dual credit while they're still in high school. And if they complete the program, they would actually come into any institution with a full year of college under their belts as well.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Senator Maher.
So this was a $30 million general fund appropriations, if I remember correctly,
yes,
right?
Yes, special appropriation, yes.
So let's go back to the first $10 million for faculty recruitment and retention. Do you have a breakdown of what's been expended so far and what's left?
Madam Chair, may Vice President Kruzmark answer that question?
Good morning. Stacy Kruzmark, Vice President for Business Administration Services at Dakota State. In November, the Board of Regents, we submitted to the Board Office, who submitted to the Appropriations Committee, a response to the letter of intent supplied. I believe that information is in there and can go through that. We can also provide an update on that. But as you know, the appropriation was passed last session in March, and so we were gearing up and trying to then attract those new faculty, and primarily that would be one of the larger expenditures. We were able to hire 1 new faculty in that short period of time. The faculty members or advertisements that Dr. Griffiths just mentioned that we're doing now, seeking, most of those would start this next fall. Very competitive environment. So we have really kind of this startup year of initial expenditures. But I would point to that report that is in the interim appropriations letter of intent response. But I think through September, we had just over $105,000 spent out of this. So again, just getting started. Next year when we are here before you, be a lot more activity, a lot more detail to share with you at that time.
And then the other question I would have is on the student recruitment and retention, how many students have you been able to recruit? And then the balance of that
Well, that's specifically, we already we got the funding at the end of March, so we did see a slight increase in students this fall, but we're going to see the big increase next fall. It's the same thing with hiring faculty. The hiring season for faculty is November through March, and so we were just a little bit late to catch that. So we really are in startup mode this year, and we hope to come back to you next year with a lot of progress in both.
And if I heard you correctly, you're targeting states like Texas? Is that where? I just don't want to us start bleeding other universities dry within the state of South Dakota, so these students are going to have to come from out of state. That's where I'm going with the question.
Senator Hamhoff, Representative Ma, yes, you're right. We're looking at areas in the country. We're focusing on areas where there is a university that has a doctoral program that's going to have doctoral graduates that we would like to grab to bring in as faculty. We're also looking to those areas, because there are programs in certain kinds of cybersecurity, to identify potential students from those areas as well. But in fairness, we also have seen an increase in the number of students from South Dakota in those programs, 4% last, just over 4% last year. And we're hoping, again, the Cyber Academy will boost that pipeline as well. So we're not ignoring potential students, but I think the students who want to come and do cybersecurity are a little bit different from the traditional student that would go to any other university, because we're the only one that has really the cybersecurity programs.
Representative Van Huysen.
Kind of following up on that, President, I've had the chance to be at the last three commencement exercises for Dakota State, because I was speaking there when I was on the board, and it's very noticeable when you're there that there are graduates from all over the country and some online and some in person. Can you speak a little bit to what portion of these are offered online and are out-of-state online type people?
Madam Chair, yes, just under 50% of our students are fully online. And so they're all over the place around the country and at military bases overseas. Of the people who are fully online, the largest majority are South Dakota residents, and the largest majority of those happen to be in Sioux Falls. So these are people who are actually working and studying for their degree, which is why they're doing their programs online. We also, just interestingly, if I were to look at the South Dakota Advantage states, we also get more students not opting for the South Dakota Advantage are fully online from those states. So I assume, again, they either don't want to move or they're working and taking their courses of study as well. What's the other question? Did that answer your question? Okay, thank you.
I just have one, and that has to do with your Cyber Academy. I was not aware that when you came and presented and you talked, this is the high school program, correct?
Yes.
Now I see you hired a dean. And then I see develop a five-year budget and revenue projections. I don't believe that was in the presentation last year. So that's one. And where's the revenue coming then for this program that you're identifying?
Madam Chair, that's a very good question. Part of the revenue, of course, is coming from the dual credit enrollment, which comes from you. But we're also going to start looking for external funding to support students who can't afford to be in the program. We, from our pilot programs in Sioux Falls, Harrisburg, Madison, there were a number of students who wanted to participate in the program but were unable to afford it. Of course, Harrisburg has a scholarship program for some of their high schoolers to take dual credit courses. I believe that some of that kind of funding could come from the private sector, who would be interested in hiring people long term.
Okay. Senator Boland, did you have a question? Foster.
Chair, yes. You mentioned that some students are unable to afford the tuition. What is the tuition or the student cost burden?
Madam Chair and Senator Foster, the students would be paying the dual credit tuition rate, and I know Heather may be behind me and could tell me that specifically, but that is a combination where the student pays, $40 per credit hour, and then the state appropriates dollars to pick up the remaining portion, which is...
Thank you.
Yeah. Just to follow up on that, along those lines, Madam Chair, so is this Cyber Academy, is it statewide?
Madam Chair, it's intended to be statewide. We've done the pilot program in sort of areas that were interested, including there's a consortium at West River that wanted us to come and teach. And so it will be available basically to any high school student that has the basic math to qualify for it. And what that does is it allows students in small high schools who wouldn't normally get the kind of AP kinds of classes to participate in this program and potentially see a future for themselves in the industry. It goes hand in hand with the other piece that I'm about to talk about, which is the development and expansion of our capabilities in Madison to Sioux Falls. So we're sort of going to be creating jobs, hopefully, for these young people to have so that they can have a good degree, have a good career, and stay in the state of South Dakota doing good work.
Senator Wick, Wink, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You've got a pretty heady group of alumni. That's a lot of them live in Washington, D.C. and whatever. But I assume you have a foundation. Can you give us an update on what's happening with your foundation?
Madam Chair, I'm going to ask Stacey Kruzmark, who was the treasurer of the foundation until very recently, so he would have the up-to-date numbers for you.
Certainly. Our overall endowment this summer, June of 2022 now, would have been just under $17 million in the DSU Foundation. Fundraising for scholarships that the foundation does is a continual challenge. We've grown in enrollment and we've grown in the academic quality of our students as well. That has put more pressure on our foundation for fundraising as well. Other things you want to mention on...
Well, we had a fundraising record last year, so we would continue. We've got new director of the foundation and an almost completely new staff there. So they are moving very quickly and extensively. But the advantage we have is not just our great alums, but we have extensive and growing relationships with the private sector. And their foundations, the foundations of the corporations, are very, very interested. And everyone in IT is very, very interested in the opportunities to bring more high school students into the IT fields, especially cybersecurity. So.
Follow up. How much did you raise last year for your foundation?
I think it's about $47 million.
And you gave that all out?
No, we didn't give it. We haven't given it all out yet. We've been increasing the endowment. We've been also raising funds for scholarships and other programs.
Thank you.
The other thing maybe to add is our new athletics event center, significant amount of funds there. As we may recall, last year we were before you to ask for that authority to construct that facility, which was 100% privately fundraised. There's a large component in there of capital dollars to spend on that capital project.
I just want to go back to the dean. I haven't been in higher ed lately, so dean makes me think that's more than a program and that you're developing something. So if you've got a dean, what kind of staff and what are you looking at growing? Is this going to be a standalone program within a division, or I don't know what your academic setting is?
Madam Chair, we wanted to have somebody who ran this program, and I wanted to have that academic flavor to it, so we defined the position as a dean. It's not going to be a dean with lots of faculty separated out. The dean will be working with the dean of College of Business, Beacom College, and also with the College of Arts and Sciences Dean to ensure that we have enough people ready to teach the programs as we move along. She will be going out and talking to school districts, going to various educational conferences across the state, and identifying the level of interest that people have in joining this program. Not everybody's going to join and want to do it at once. This program has a heavy portion of mentoring associated with it, so there will be peer mentors who are our juniors and seniors in college will be mentoring the student classes. There is also summer camps and other things available, but this is not going to grow. The academy may have multiple programs. The academy thus far has had two programs that we've offered. We're going to probably go back and start with one as we launch this new program. But we had one in cybersecurity and we had one in cyber leadership and intelligence, which is a slightly different flavor of cybersecurity.
Thank you. Continue.
Okay, thank you. So as you are aware, in parallel with SB 54, we received funds from Mr. Denny Sanford to construct a 100,000 square foot research facility in Sioux Falls. We received $50 million from Mr. Sanford, and we received $10 million from the City of Sioux Falls for construction and programmatic funding. Senate Bill 130 authorized the construction in Sioux Falls. So since the bills were signed, we have hired Architecture, Inc. and Journey Construction as architect and construction company. We started the programming and design of the building. At its recent meetings, the last two meetings, the Board of Regents approved the transfer of 10 acres of land from Sanford Health to DSU. They approved the facility program plan, and we're currently starting the next design phase, which is called schematic design. The Regents approved the creation of the DSU Applied Research Corporation, which will run the Applied Research Lab both in Madison and South Dakota. And we anticipate that by the end of September, we will transition the research engineers and staff that we have in Madison to the Applied Research Corporation. So they will no longer be state employees. We'll take them off the rolls. It makes everybody a little bit more comfortable, I think. So that's all gone ahead. We were pleased to hear Governor Noem include a reference to this large-scale initiative in her State of the State address. I thought you might be interested in three research highlights. First of all, House Bill 1092 authorized for cyber agriculture funding to DSU and SDSU. Again, we thank you for the support. An initiative called Cyber Safe South Dakota, and we joined an international artificial intelligence cyber consortium. So the cyber agricultural funding, SDSU and DSU received $1.5 million for collaborative research in the area of cybersecurity and precision agriculture. Thus far, we have awarded $250,000 to each of two collaborative research proposals that are looking at cybersecurity and precision ag. Two additional proposals were not funded, one because it didn't include cybersecurity, and the other one was disqualified for missing the submission deadline. But I wanted you to know we're not just giving money to every proposal that came in from faculty. A symposium including both researchers and the agricultural industry is in the works to discuss both precision agriculture and cybersecurity concerns and problems, research results, and develop a research agenda for the industry-university consortium that's envisioned. I think you'll be hearing more about this tomorrow when SDSU is here. Last fall, we received a $1 million award from the U.S. Small Business Administration to help and protect and train small businesses. Small businesses are those with fewer than 500 employees. Currently, 60 businesses have enrolled and 480 employees have been trained. Only three awards were made across the United States, one to the Maryland Bureau of Labor, one to the Fortis Institute in Arkansas, and one only university award was to DSU. This $1 million is for a one-year pilot, and if deemed successful, there'll be 3 to 4 years of funding available from the Small Business Administration. Briefly, we are a founding member of the International AI Edge Learning Consortium. If you really want to know what that is, I'd be happy to send you a little description of what edge learning is, but it's about putting more intelligence on devices that we use every day. We had a collaborative student-faculty exchange with AI Sweden and Chalmers University in Gothenburg, Sweden. We had one faculty member and four students, and Chalmers had three students, so the students spent 5 weeks in Gothenburg, Sweden, followed by 5 weeks in Madison, South Dakota. They collaborated on a project involving data poisoning in driverless car environments. Again, I'd be happy to explain to you what that is, but it's really cutting-edge stuff that our students are engaged in. And then this past fall, the four research-oriented regional institutions helped form a broader regional research consortium called the Mountains and Plains University Alliance. DSU has been designated the consortium cybersecurity lead. This is for South Dakota, North Dakota, Montana, Wyoming, and Idaho. That's the five-state consortium. We've already been successful in an NSF I-Corps proposal with SDSU, MINES, UND, NDSU, University of Wyoming, and University of Nebraska, Omaha. This was a $14 million award from the National Science Foundation aimed at increasing our capability to pursue entrepreneurial opportunities and funding from the federal government. And then all these kinds of initiatives take a lot of effort, and here's the team that's been out trying to engage partners. Just to let you know, this picture is with the Deputy Director of the Cybersecurity Infrastructure Security Agency. We were in Washington, D.C. And I'll let Mr. Kruse-Mark address the last two slides. Thank you.
Certainly. Some of this information you've seen before, but just touching on the National Guard reimbursement was recommended by the governor in her budget address. I think we discussed with the board's presentation the tuition freeze, which we requested in September based on a anticipated 6% salary policy. The governor recommended 5% and did not recommend the tuition freeze. However, we certainly have commented on the value of that, especially to the purchasing power that our students would then have. The last piece that the governor did have in her budget recommendation was an increased utility cost adjustment. That is for the academic buildings on our campus. And that would be the increased cost for utilities projected by the governor's office and BFM. And then the last slide just shows the budgeted FTE at Dakota State University for the last two fiscal years compared to what we utilized in those years. I think that is our final slide. So,
very good. Senator Wink.
Thank you. Once the facility is built in Sioux Falls, what percentage of your faculty and students are going to be between Madison and Sioux Falls? Can you give us some kind of an outlook of where you're looking?
Mr. Chair? Absolutely.
Continue.
We'll not have any of our students working there. We will. It's a research facility. It's a work facility. It's for doing government contract work. So it's not an educational facility in that sense. Now, a few faculty may work there part-time on a project, but really we're going to have full-time research engineers that are hired to work on the contracts. So almost separate from DSU, but where our graduates will hopefully land.
Mm-hmm. Senator Boland.
Real briefly, what percentage of your students actually live in Madison? Are maybe they come from Elk Point or Beersford or someplace, but they're maybe more what we call traditional students living there in Madison. It seems like a lot of your students are hither and yon, which is wonderful, you know. But
about half our students, so we were at 32, 41, I think it was, so about half of them are on campus.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Senator Maher.
So just to follow up is what we heard from President Nichols, are your dorms full then, are exceeding capacity, or what's the status there?
Mr. Chair, I told Stacy that he would have to answer that question because it probably would come up to us.
Mr. Chair, Stacy Kruse-Mark, I was pulling up that number. It is 87.39% at this fall. It was about 811 students that we had. We just built a new residence hall that opened fall of 21, adding 122. So. Hence, our percentage is down a little bit because we add that capacity. It's obviously something very important to all our communities to have enough of that housing. So adding that recently was a great addition to DSU.
Further questions? No further questions?
Chair.
Yes, Senator Foster.
Yes, it was mentioned that there was an athletic facility. What athletics do you support?
Mr. Chair, we actually have 11 sports at the varsity level. Our athletics facility, the athletics event center, football stadium, and track and soccer field are part of that initiative. Fully funded by private funds, but football, men's and women's basketball, volleyball, baseball, softball, esports, which is our new sport, and the largest number of students engaged in it. What else have I missed? Track and field.
Follow up? Okay. Any further questions? I'd like to thank you for being here today.
Thank you for your time.
Is there any public testimony this morning? Very good. We had conversation with president of NSU, and since they're the only thing standing between us and lunch, they have graciously agreed to come back tomorrow morning, correct,
at 8 o'clock. We're going to start early at 8 o'clock and have them first. Anything else for the good of the cause?
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I have a set of minutes to move. Is that in order at this time?
Yes.
I move that we approve the minutes of Friday, January 20, 2023, which was the overview of the Department of Public Safety.
Second. Motion by Representative Ben Heisen, second by Senator Boland. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Are there any other minutes? Anything else, Senator Breitling?
No.
We will see you back at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. I have a motion to adjourn from Senator Colbeck, seconded by Representative Carr. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We are.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net.